This has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports. For more, log on to ESPN.com. It's Dale and Dale on the front row at Michigan as we get set for the Pepsi 400. You don't even need the remote.
Nestled within the Irish hills of southern Michigan is the 2 mile Michigan Speedway, where the 22nd race of the NASCAR Winston Cup season is about to begin. The Pepsi 400.
1 week ago at Watkins Glen, New York native Steve Park realized a dream by capturing his first ever Winston Cup win. His emotion was reminiscent of another first-time winner here at Michigan 9 years ago today.
They bump, they touch, they rub, going down the backstretch, side by side, wheel to wheel, they touch, coming down through the tri-oval, at the line, who wins it? I believe Chad.
It is not a first win that points leader Bobby Labonte is focused on. After all, he has three of those already here in Michigan. Rather, it's the vision of being the next to follow Dale Jarrett as a first-time Winston Cup champion that continues to consume Bobby's thoughts each and every Sunday. Last week, Bobby Labonte did what he had to do. He survived Watkins Glen without a glitch and managed a top-five finish, thus extending his points lead to a season-high 101 over Dale Jarrett. This week, he visits one of his best tracks with one of his best cars. Michigan has provided him with three of his 14 career wins. And this particular car, well, in 8 starts, he has won twice and finished no worse than third ever. All that sounds like a recipe for a championship. Until you consider that one broken engine part, one cut tire, or one ignition glitch resulting in a 29th place finish or worse, coupled with a Jarrett win, and Bobby can head to Bristol second in points. And now you know why he looked so worried just a moment ago.
Dale Earnhardt and Rusty Wallace are two true champions trying to rebound from one bad weekend. Earnhardt hit the road to destruction early, and when he found a new home in the foam, he had backed up another 72 points in the championship race. He's lost 172 points in the last 3 events. Rusty Wallace will look back at Watkins Glen and wonder what happened. By the time the dust had settled, he'd lost one car, one position in the standings, and 99 precious points. And speaking of 99, 4 races ago, Jeff Burton was 7th in points, 221 out of the lead. Today, he's 4th in points, 221 out of the lead. Jeff Burton has 7 top 3 finishes this year. That's second only to Bobby Labonte, who has 8. Burton's best finish here, 3rd. These 3 drivers have the same motive and mission: make a run at victory lane and try and prevent a runaway in the points. Earnhardt is a 2-time winner here, but hasn't won at Michigan since June of 1990. Wallace has 4 wins at this track, and his only win in this race came exactly 11 years ago today. This afternoon, we may find out if these 3 racers can continue on course towards challenging for the championship, or if last week put them on the wrong road for good. And as we saw at Watkins Glen, the action and the anger often begin early.
Those 2 young guns start 16th and 19th today on the grid. It'll be worth watching just to see how careful they are around each other. Because even if it is unintentional, a little tap here or a little tap there will only fuel the fire of what could become one of the best rivalries in NASCAR. Gordon, the established champion, versus Stewart, the upstart, with 6 wins in about a season and a half. NASCAR needs this rivalry to develop. They lit the fire last week at Watkins Glen. The flames need to be flamed today before they burn out.
On a beautiful Sunday afternoon, it is time to get this event underway here at Michigan Speedway. Get set to compete for 200 miles on this 2-mile racetrack in the Pepsi 400. It is-
is absolutely beautiful here today. The sun is shining. It's a temperature of around 72 degrees. We're anticipating an absolutely incredible race here this afternoon. The NASCAR Winston Cup Series, after 21 races last year, saw Dale Jarrett with a 300-point lead. Now he has 100-point deficit to Bobby Labonte. These top 10 drivers have a combined 19 wins here at this facility. Hi, everyone. I'm Bob Jenkins, along with a former couple NASCAR champions, Ned Jarrett, Benny Parsons. Unlike last Sunday when we were on the twisting and turning road course, we have a nice wide racetrack here with sweeping turns. The same track they started competing on here in 1969. Or is it, Benny?
Oh, no. Well, the racetrack is exactly the same, but the cars, everything is a great deal different. Normally, when these cars go to the racetrack twice in 1 year, between the first and second race, just subtle changes are made in the car. But today, sitting on pit road, these cars have had wholesale changes since June, and some of the guys still confused, are we good enough to win, even though we've changed our car a great deal?
What they've been trying to figure out is the new generation tire. When they were here in June, a lot of them didn't have that figured out. They're running a much softer spring setup than they were back then. They've learned that that's what the cars and those tires want nowadays. Now, this track is so wide that you can get a big variety as far as RPMs are concerned. Gearing. If you're set up for the low groove, then you might want a low gear to get you off the corners. But if you're set up for a high groove, you could use a higher gear. But if you're set up for that low groove and the groove is upstairs on the high side of the racetrack, you could be in trouble because you've over-revved that engine.
And, Ned, it is also a very fast racetrack. In fact, Michigan now is the third fastest track in terms of qualifying speed. Dale Earnhardt Jr. set a new track record here on Friday at 191.149 miles an hour. Sports and the National Association for Stock Car Auto Racing invite you to settle back on this Sunday afternoon and enjoy with us the Pepsi 400 from Michigan Speedway, the starting lineup when we come back. ESPN's coverage of the Pepsi 400 from Michigan Speedway is being brought to you by Pepsi, proud sponsor of the Michigan Speedway, and the Pepsi 400. By Daytona USA, the official attraction of NASCAR. And by brand name tires, oil changes, and more at your neighborhood Walmart Tire and Lube Express. Michigan Speedway is a 2 mile oval. Front stretch 3,600 feet, the back stretch 2,242, and the corners are banked at 18 degrees. It is a very wide racetrack. And we are seeing history of a sort made here today. For the first time in the modern era, a driver, namely Dale Earnhardt, who won earlier this year at Atlanta, will have two sons in the starting lineup. Dale Earnhardt Jr. and Kerry here making his NASCAR Winston Cup debut. Now here's the Walmart Tire and Lube Express starting lineup. Dale Earnhardt Jr. is on the pole at over 191. Dale Jarrett, the defending series champion, is outside. Rick Mast in the second row has his best start since February of 1998. Ricky Rudd joins him in the second row. In the third row, Bobby Labonte and Jeremy Mayfield returning to action. Then it's Mark Martin and Jerry Nadeau making up row number four. In the fifth row, Ward Burton and Rusty Wallace. Scott Pruitt and Ken Schrader will begin from the sixth row. In row number seven, it's Ricky Craven and Mike Skinner. Then Steve Park, last week's winner at Watkins Glen, and Jeff Gordon. Bill Elliott will start 17th alongside Michael Waltrip. Then Tony Stewart, who won here in June alongside Wally Dallenbach. Sterling Marlin and Dave Blaney will begin from the 21st and 22nd positions. Johnny Benson and Jeff Burton go from row number 12. In the 13th row, it's Joe Nemechek and Hunt Strickland. Then Kerry Earnhardt making his debut, 27 starter, and Matt Kenseth. John Andretti and Kevin LePage are in the next row. Then Mike Bliss and Elliott Sadler. Terry Labonte is back on board the Kellogg Chevy. He'll drop to the rear of the field because Todd Bodine qualified the car. Andy Houston makes his Winston Cup debut here this afternoon. He'll start beside Chad Little. Dale Earnhardt had to take a provisional. So did Robert Presley, who ran so well here earlier. Jimmy Spencer and Ted Musgrave. Bobby Hamilton, Brett Bodine, and the next to the last row. And the 43rd and final starting position goes to Robbie Gordon. Here are the drivers who failed to qualify for this event. David Keith, Carl Long, Kyle Petty, Darrell Waltrip, Stacy Compton. This is his first race of his rookie year, and Jeffrey Bodine.
We'll check out our onboard cameras. Elliott Sadler started back in 32nd, has the Citgo on board. Jeff Burton, the Parts Plus onboard camera, starts in 24th position. Bill Elliott will be taking McDonald's car for a ride through the drive-thru and starts 17th. Mike Skinner has the Lowe's Home Improvement Warehouse car, starts 14th. Rusty Wallace, a Miller Lite onboard camera, starts in 10th position this afternoon. Ward Burton has the Husqvarna onboard. He starts 9th. Bobby Labonte, again, the Circuit City onboard camera, as he usually does, starts 5th. Rick Mast, great qualifying run for Rick. He's 3rd today in the Casico onboard camera. Dale Jarrett outside that front row, the Ford Quality Care camera. On the pole, the Budweiser onboard camera with Dale Earnhardt Jr.
We will go 200 laps. That will make up the 400 miles. The purse exceeds $2 million, and the pit window here is between 48 and 54 laps. Jerry, they're just about ready to go in a half lap.
Bob, an oil leak in Dale Jarrett's car during happy hour was diagnosed as a cracked oil pan. Now, because NASCAR wanted to close the garage, they pulled the engine out, took it out behind the motorhome lot, and basically rebuilt the engine until midnight last night, then put it back in at 7 o'clock this morning. The last time DJ rebuilt an engine in a parking lot of Michigan was spring of 99. He led 160 of 200 laps on that day. John Kernan?
Benny already mentioned the surprisingly great qualifying run by Rick Mast, but keep an eye on their pit crew today, because crew chief Felipe Lopez says they've hired Gary Smith from DEI to train the crew. They're doing 10 stops a day. Last week, they were all in the 14 to 15 second range. To Bill Weber.
A lot of behind the scenes heroes, but of the 18 or the 20 wins today, John Malloy could be the biggest. He's the wiring engineer for Gibbs Racing. He completely changed the ignition system on the 18 and won Fox in the 20 after they found a problem here on Saturday. A lot of heroes, he could be one of them. They come to get the green, Bob.
Pace car is off the racetrack. Dale Earnhardt Jr. leads them down for the second time in his Winston Cup career. And the green flag drops. We're underway at Michigan.
Then Tony Stewart on the bottom of the racetrack trying to work his way to the front.
Third run. Now Bobby Labonte drops in behind Ricky.
Rick Mast off to a good start. He's up in second place.
Rest of
fourth out. Here.
Gets a little bit high on the ball. Bobby Labonte gets to the inside. Meanwhile, coming down to lead the first lap is going to be Dale Earnhardt Jr. First time he has led since Dover.
Richie Craven trying to get on by some cars, trying to get inside Scott Pruitt, and Pruitt's car wiggles, and Bill Elliott right in the middle of all that stuff, and Mike Skinner high on the racetrack, followed closely by Jeff Gordon.
They're in three and four deep back in the pack.
Pruitt moves up alongside Wally Dallenbach.
That's Elliott's car on the bottom of the racetrack, but it looks to be white sides, battle for second spot.
Dale Jarrett coming to the inside and at the line leads Rick Mast, and Mast will drop in behind him. So put Jarrett up to second now as Dale Earnhardt Jr. still has the lead. Rick Mast running in third spot, and Bobby Labonte working the high side of the racetrack trying to move up. It looks like he's going to be able to do so.
Boy, he has a run coming off of turn two and just blows by. Rick Mast pulls right up on the back bumper of Dale Jarrett. Bobby Labonte's car was very good in happy hour yesterday afternoon. He's going to try Jarrett on the outside here coming off of turn four. That's not going to work this time.
Have some telemetry on board Rick Mast-Canseco car. But let's go back and watch Jerry Nadeau and Rusty Wallace. There's Ward Burton, Mike Skinner, Jeff Gordon. That's a battle back for about the 14th, 15th position.
Here's a battle for second. Bobby Labonte gets that run off of turn two once again, like he did on Rick Mast the last time. Does it on Dale Jarrett this time.
Jarrett, though, will battle back as he moves his car down to the low side of the racetrack. Labonte, with the RPMs build up, will go into second spot. Three wide racing back here. That's Tony Stewart, who is still working the low side of the racetrack. Ward Burton alongside him. Ken Schrader looking on along with Elliott.
Happy hour last night, kept running the bottom of the racetrack, stayed on the bottom of the racetrack like he's trying to run 400 miles down there. And as Ned Jarrett said, if he decides he needs to go to the top today, he could turn that Home Depot body at too many RPMs.
Here's Ricky Rudd trying to make a run on Rick Mast, right in the fifth position. Mast actually, yeah, fourth and fifth.
Here comes Jeremy Mayfield off the corner on the inside of Ricky Rudd. Trying to take over that fourth spot.
Boy, Mayfield had a great run here back in June. He was anxious to get back in that number 12 and get to this racetrack.
Oh, Jeremy gets a little loose getting in that corner. Had to back up behind Ricky Rudd, I should say.
Kerry Earnhardt has crashed in his Winston Cup debut. The Real Tree Chevy, extensive right side damage.
Well, that's too bad. He's not going to get the experience that he'd hoped to get. Of course, the wrong kind of experience. He'd hoped to run a lot of laps here today.
Kerry has experience in the Busch Grand National Series and also in ARCA, where he's been running this year. He does get the Real Tree Chevy refired, but it does bring out the caution. He won an ARCA race earlier this year at Pocono and has four top fives in his five starts.
You can see that right front wheel is towed out so much that it's actually sliding across the racetrack. That's what the smoke you see.
Take a look at what happened up in the third turn.
Looked like he was up on the outside. Couldn't tell how close another car was when it first started, but it was up in the very high groove and just slammed right up into the wall.
Well, there's extensive damage to the car, so Kerry will take it behind the wall. We'll take a break and be back with more from Michigan Speedway, where Dale Earnhardt Jr. leads. Welcome back to Michigan Speedway, where the Pepsi 400 is underway with Dale Earnhardt Jr. at the front of the field and the caution out because of his older brother, Kerry, who crashed up in turn three. During this caution period, we saw several cars on pit road. Now, somewhat unusual, but then again, obviously these guys were saying, hey, things aren't right and I need some help.
Yeah, they'd only run seven laps, and those cars at the back of the pack, about 13 of them, decided to come in, make some adjustments and change tires. And Jerry, a lot of things going on there.
Well, down in the car number one pits, the Pinzall pits for Steve Park, he made a pit stop here a lap ago on lap number seven. That the car was pushing, and historically this racetrack gets tighter and tighter as you go along. So if you start out with a push, it's going to be plowing by the time they make their first scheduled stop at around lap 50. They came in, took a rubber out of the left rear, one round of wedge out, and trying to free the car up in the middle of the corner. Let's check in with Bill Weber.
Well, on the 22 car, Ward Burton very, very loose. So they came in, of course, they got four tires and fuel, made an air pressure adjustment, put three rounds of wedge in the left rear. And Ward ran so well here yesterday. Now let's get an update in the garage from John Kernan.
Kerry Earnhardt has climbed from his car. Kerry, what happened?
We just sat there. Car was a little loose there at the start, and Dave Marcus is coaching me on. He was taking it easy and everything, and went turn three, the car got up under me and took the air off, and it went all around as loose as it was. There wasn't no way I was going to hold it. And we were just trying to, you know, stay out of trouble and just be patient and be able to get the first caution, come in and tighten it up, but didn't work out that way.
There were some drivers reporting to their crews before the accident that there was oil out on the racetrack, so he may have gotten into that.
Dave Marcus looking on as they try to make repairs to that car. We'll take a break under caution here with eight laps completed. It's Dale Earnhardt Jr. and Bobby Labonte up front.
Go, go, go.
The word goes out to go, go, go. We are back to racing. Dale Earnhardt Jr. back here in the pack a little bit. That's Tony Stewart down to the inside of Jeff Gordon. We know what happened between those two last week, but Stewart on the bottom of the track really makes up some ground.
And Jerry Nadeau in the middle of the racetrack got off to a terrible. It's like something's wrong with the car, but maybe he just got a bad restart.
And to the inside, here comes Scott Pruitt in that 32 Tide car, and Sterling Marlin also. Colin back runs the middle of the track with Nadeau up high.
Jerry Nadeau on the restart was running in ninth position and now is back to 16th. He lost seven positions that lap.
Tony Stewart picked up about that many on that lap.
Johnny Benson in the 10 car, and the announcement was made yesterday that Valvoline will become part owner of that team next year. And look at the difference in the grooves being used here. Labonte way down low and Earnhardt up about as high as he can get.
And that's Labonte was up high the first few laps of this race, but now he's gone to the bottom. Tony Stewart is still on the bottom of the racetrack. It looks like he has chosen that to be his groove in today's race. And you know, the strange thing is his car seemed to work so well high in June.
Tony has moved up to the 10th spot.
As those tires get heated up, it might be difficult to keep it right at the bottom of the racetrack. He can make it work for himself now. He's just down on the inside of Jeremy Mayfield.
And Rusty Wallace, you and I, great minds work together. Rusty Wallace and Ricky Rudd try to get by the Conseco car to take over the fourth position.
Bobby Labonte took a look at Dale Earnhardt Jr. Now he's going to try to move down on the inside.
Well, Junior's very, very high on the racetrack. And Bobby Labonte takes the lead.
On board with Mike Skinner, looking back to Jeremy Mayfield. And look at Tony Stewart once again diving down to the bottom of the track, getting those left side tires actually below the yellow line.
Now that's the line that I kept expecting to see in qualifying on Friday afternoon, that no one would run. They all ran the middle to the top of the racetrack.
Tony trying to take over the seventh position from Skinner. And it looks like he will get the job done.
Tony Stewart started back in 19th position. Meanwhile, Dale Jarrett, outside pole sitter, gets by Dale Jr. to take second spot. Ooh, Junior's coming back.
There. Yeah, he got up there and took the air off of Jared's spoiler. Jared had to get out of the gas. And Bobby Labonte was able to pull away while they were doing that little maneuver.
Dale Jarrett and Earnhardt Jr. still fighting for that second spot, Jerry.
Dale Jarrett told Todd Parrott a moment ago that his car was very loose when he tried to run the top of the racetrack. He was going to move down to the middle groove or even lower if he could. Once he moved down, the car tightened up, and now it is much more to his liking. Meanwhile, Dale Earnhardt Jr. is complaining of the opposite problem. His car has gotten tight off the corners. He can't keep the car down. Opening up the inside, he pretty easily passed.
Well, Jarrett loses a couple of spots here, lost it to Dale Earnhardt Jr., and now Rusty Wallace has also been able to get around.
Rusty went into turn one right on Jarrett's bumper, was going to try to help him push DJ by Dale Earnhardt Jr., but it loosened DJ's car up so much, he had to back off the gas. Rusty just drove by him on the outside.
And now Rusty looks to second spot as he is wheel-to-wheel with Earnhardt Jr., and now completes the pass, so Rusty Wallace up to second position, but about a second and a half behind Bobby Labonte.
Well, these guys doing all that racing back there. Bobby Labonte looking in his rearview mirror and loving it.
Ricky Rudd. Junior's just does not want to give these spots up.
Car on the move is the 99. Jeff Burton has picked up the most positions since the green flag dropped.
He said that his car was good in happy hour yesterday. I watched him make a long, long run, and his car was good.
Jeff currently running in the ninth spot.
He started in 24th position. And the eighth car still running side by side is Jarrett and Rudd.
We don't have any serious racing while we go back just briefly to check on Jeff Burton. There he is, only now about 4.5 seconds behind the leader and closing in on the car running just ahead of him, and that would be Jeremy Mayfield.
And Jeff Burton has passed a lot of good race cars from where he has come from.
Rick Mast, on the other hand, is losing spots. Here comes the 10 of Johnny Benson up to take away a position, and that will drop him back another one. John, what's going on with Rick?
Bob, right now, Rick is complaining that the car has picked up a terrible push. He goes into the turns. The front end does not want to turn at all. Wants to push up toward the wall. So they want to hang on till the first pit stop, make some chassis adjustments and some air pressure adjustments to the tires to try and loosen that car up.
Well, he just lost 17th position and is about to lose 18th as Matt Kenseth has gone right up to the rear spoiler.
And here goes Tony Stewart, still right on that yellow line around 1 and 2.
Well, he's got that thing dialed in. He can go just about anywhere he wants to go. And he's the only one that I've seen so far that is able to consistently run down low and make it work.
And he worked on that all happy hour last night. The whole hour he spent on the bottom of the racetrack running some very long extended runs. Oh, baby. Trying to make sure that his chassis was going to be okay, because he felt like the entire field was going to be at the top of the racetrack, and to be able to pass, he needs to be able to do it on the bottom. And it looks like that strategy is working perfectly as he's trying his best to take over the third position.
Well, in the center of the corner, he doesn't have any company down there. He's down there all by himself. Those other race cars are way up the racetrack. But when he comes off of the turn, of course, he has to drift up in there where they are. There he goes. Cuts her down there again.
Looks like there's 15 bus lengths between those two cars.
And Stewart will take over.
Not yet. Not quite. Earnhardt's got a run going into the turn. He's running a much shorter racetrack than the others are running. But Benny mentioned earlier about the possible gearing situation, if he has to go up the top side, would he turn too many RPMs? But as Benny said, he worked on that low groove yesterday in happy hour, so I'm sure that they geared it accordingly.
All this from the Pennzoil copter cam circling overhead Michigan Speedway, which will become Michigan International Speedway, like it used to be called, officially tomorrow. And now a big group of cars running here, including Dale Earnhardt, who's threading his way through the field. He's currently up to 19.
And he's one of those drivers that made a pit stop.
That's during that exactly right.
So, boy, they've made some big improvements on his Chevrolet.
And we saw Mike Skinner up front earlier on in the 31 car. Now he is struggling as he falls back to the field, as DJ and Rudd still battling over that fifth position.
Jeremy Mayfield in car number 12 right there saying, which one of these guys do I want to follow?
Either one.
No, he's saying, I'll just go down here and do my own deal.
Oh, and Brett Bodine has smoke coming from his Ralph's supermarket Ford Taurus.
Caution is out.
And the caution is out. Second time for the caution. 24 laps are completed. Bobby Labonte has now led 11 of the last 12 Michigan races. He's out front here today.
Welcome back to Pit Road on Michigan. Under caution, pit stops happening. Jeremy Mayfield's car very loose. Four tires, a half round down on the track bar, and one round of wedge in the left rear as they try and tighten that car up. Work is finished. On the right side, they'll swing around to the left. Let's go down to Bill Weber.
Bob, Bobby Labonte and Tony Stewart on the top and the bottom with Rusty Wallace in the middle. The 18 and the 20 have been good. Rusty's already away. Looked like a two-tire stop from here. Left side around Labonte. His car's been pretty good. Same for Tony Stewart. No changes at this point.
And now the rush off pit road. Looks like that several took two tires and gained significant track position, among them with Jeff Gordon, who I believe is going to be second when they come out.
Every car on the racetrack stopped.
Elliott Sadler leaving, so is Dave Blaney, and down to Jerry Punch.
Guys, Dale Earnhardt Jr. said his car was perfect in turns one and two, but entering turn three, he developed a severe push. The car would not turn. He said, don't mess it up for me in turns one and two, but try to help me a little bit in turn three. So they made an air pressure adjustment on the left side. Now, as for Dale Jarrett, I mentioned he had been very loose while running up high. They decided to go ahead and make air pressure and a track bar change on the 88 car, try to help DJ be able to drive the car into the corner without getting the back end loose. They hope it'll help the 88 and the 8 car as we get set for green here momentarily.
And the track crew is cleaning up some oil on the racetrack from Brett Bodine's car. So after 26 laps, we'll take another break and be back in a moment. Caution for the second time here at the Pepsi 400. They are racing here in Michigan today, and they are also at the X Games, which are underway in San Francisco. Here's ESPN's Chris Fowler with a preview of what's coming up after our race.
Thanks, Bob. Here in San Francisco, the masses have stormed the pier for X Games 2000. Racing is the theme of today's coverage. The course and the mode of transport a bit different than they are in Michigan. Street luge racing, six guys on sleds all going down the Seal Rock Run course in the Supermass. They reach speeds of over 50 miles per hour. Afterwards, we're sending speed bikes down the same course to see how they handle the famed Cliff House turn. Plenty of speed today at the X Games. Coming up next, immediately following the Pepsi 400. Bob?
Well, when you have a crash in those luges, you really have a crash, don't you? We're looking forward to the X Games coming up after our coverage of the Pepsi 400. Well, the crew cam is being worn by Bobby Burrell from Steve Park's crew. Let's watch him in action, BP.
Front tire changer. When you win a race, you get on TV the next week. Burrell takes the five luck nuts off. He throws that tire off. The changer, Billy Soufin, sticks the tire on. They go around the left side. And folks, we did not speed this film, this tape up. This is the way it goes on pit road. All right, let's go. Let's get there. Get out of here. There you go. Good stop.
That's unbelievable. It really is. Let's check a Coke pit summary here and see who lost and gained during this pit stop. Rusty Wallace moved up a spot. Look at Jeff Gordon, who gained eight positions. And Jerry Nadeau, wow, up to third from 21st. Bobby Labonte lost three, and Tony Stewart lost a couple of positions. Doc?
And Rusty Wallace's pit stop, two right side tires only, mild air pressure adjustment in the right rear because the car was tight completely through the corners, but 9 seconds flat for Rusty's pit stop. That's why he's leading. Let's go to Bill.
For Mike Skinner, he was too tight. 1 pound out of the right rear, rubber out of the right rear, and a round down on the left rear. John?
Jeremy Mayfield lost a bunch of spots on pit road when a lug nut fell off the left front tire during that pit stop. That cost you a couple of seconds, and you see what a couple of seconds does there. On the other end of the spectrum, Dale Earnhardt's crew just pulled off one of the fastest pit stops I think I've ever seen. Four tires, fuel, no changes, and get this, 14.21 seconds.
Wow. Good job by the crew. It's Rusty Wallace, Jeff Gordon, Jerry Nadeau, Bobby Labonte, and Tony Stewart, the top five after 28 of 200 laps. It didn't miss a thing. We have just now gone green once again. And Tony Stewart once again heads for the bottom of the racetrack, gets to the inside of his teammate Bobby Labonte, but Labonte has some work to do with Jerry Nadeau.
Labonte just turns left and goes under Nadeau. He'll take over that third spot. Meanwhile, Earnhardt Jr. somehow got between the 18 and 20. I'm not sure exactly how he did that.
On board with Bobby Labonte, looking back to Stewart and Nadeau.
Trying to follow
Dale Earnhardt Jr. and draft by Labonte. Jr. makes that pass. He moves into the second spot, looks for in the first spot, looks for second down the backstretch.
Well,
Earnhardt just made a great move around both Dale Jarrett and Ricky Rudd coming off turn two. Passed them both from the outside.
He is up to the eighth spot now. Here comes Rudd. Meanwhile, up front, Wallace still has the lead, but Dale Earnhardt Jr. has gone to second, passing Jeff Gordon, and now Bobby Labonte begins to work on Jeff. Well, I don't think there's any doubt that Earnhardt Jr. has a very fast race car. He's moved through the field quickly from that pit stop.
Yes, he did. Earnhardt Jr. looks awfully good today. I'm sure that Jeff Gordon, Rusty Wallace, these guys have changed two tires. Really, truly, they were trying to figure out later on in the race what the car is going to do when they change left just two tires to make sure that they can make the proper adjustment for a two-tire change later that last pit stop trying to get the track position.
Well, the Dale and Dale show there with Earnhardt up high and Jarrett down low. Also up there, right in the middle of things, is Bill Elliott, who has a good run going. He's just outside the top 10 now.
Meanwhile, Bobby Labonte goes by Junior. Take over that second. Well, he tried to go by Junior to take over the second spot.
Bobby
loose.
Wow. Yes, he did get loose and really wiggle with him.
Once again, we have Stewart and Gordon running very close to each other. Crowd remembers what happened last week at Watkins Glen and are watching these two very carefully, but both of them have said, hey, that's past history. It was forgotten about after last Sunday.
Even the Dale Earnhardt fans are watching the 20 and 24 right now. And Bobby Labonte, I don't guess he liked that loose part very much, so he backs up a little bit. The last time he came through this corner, he's battling for second. Now he's battling for the third position. And Jeff Burke, the next side car, comes in the frame.
And here comes Dale Earnhardt, sneaking up on him, too.
And watch Earnhardt, he's going to go that high groove. And way down low there, Dale Jarrett and Ricky Rudd sort of in the middle. And Earnhardt's going to prevail, and Rudd will get by Jarrett.
And Bobby Labonte has lost a couple more spots. He was battling for second. Now he's battling back for about the sixth position. And Earnhardt is on the outside of Jeff Burton. Does Jeff know he's there? Yes, his partner had warned him. Bobby Hudson said he's on the outside. So he backs up and follows Earnhardt. And now Jerry Nadeau trying to get by Bobby Labonte.
And Earnhardt is as high on the racetrack as you can run without getting... Oh, we have a crash.
And yes, he hits it.
Tony Stewart spins right in the path of Jeff Gordon. And once again, the caution comes out, the third of the race in the first 36 laps. So the winner here in June suffers a major setback here in the early part of this event at Michigan Speedway. Damage to the front end and the back end of the Home Depot Pontiac. And we saw Jeff Gordon run into Tony Stewart. Not a great deal of damage, but then again, up there on the left front of the car, it could mean...
Well, he's flat side the right side against the wall and hit Tony Stewart with the left front. So he's got both sides of the DuPont Chevrolet.
And he's headed down pit road. Even though pit road was not open, they had no choice. He and Tony Stewart both coming down pit road. And then he needs to get in and get the work started on this car.
Well, Tony will take the car directly to the garage area. Let's take a look at what happened.
Tony Stewart on the bottom. Oh, there we see. It goes in the corner and gets it loose, getting in. And Junior somehow sensed that he was in trouble, and he goes up the racetrack. And there we see Jeff Gordon hit him with the left front and then go up and hit the wall with the right side. And Elliott just barely gets by.
Several drivers do a good job of evasive driving from another angle.
Just got loose on him. He tried to correct it, chased it up the hill a little bit. Touched Dale Earnhardt Jr. right up in front of Jeff Gordon.
And Dale Earnhardt in the three car just barely gets by. And there's Nate doing Elliott just somehow splitting the 20 car.
From the Pennzoil copter cam, this overhead view. Ooh, Earnhardt came so close to hitting that car. And look at Bill Elliott.
Here, let's watch Bill Elliott. He'll go down in turn one, goes by the start-finish line, and he's going to have a windshield full of Tony Stewart before this lap's over.
Okay, there's the smoke. Where do I go? Start below, and then said, oh, that's not the place to be.
Now on board with Dale Earnhardt Jr.
Strictly coincidental that the 24 and the 20 got together there.
But in any case, the race is under its third caution, Bill.
Well, for the third straight race, Jeff Gordon involved in an early race collision. He has shut off the DuPont Chevrolet. They have heavy damage on the right side and the left. They've torn away sheet metal here on the left side. They're working on the suspension on the right side. They were concerned about the toe. They've taken the tire off. Now they're going to put it back on. They want to try and fix the nose piece. Jeff talking it over with Robbie Loomis. But working right now on the right front tire and looking at the suspension parts on the left side as well. Now they lower the jack and let's see. Gordon's going to sit here for a minute while they go ahead and, again, it looks like they're going to go ahead and check. Now looks like they might be pushing it back. Yes, he's got a broken brake rotor, it looks like now. We just saw him. They kicked it out from beneath the car, Benny.
Yeah, I saw that, Bill. I saw him. It's too hot to pick up, so they were kicking it around the car. And you see it sitting against pit wall there, the broken brake rotor.
Dale Earnhardt Jr. was very close to Tony Stewart when he lost it. Looks like that his car is relatively unscathed.
Well, if he has damage, it would be on the left side, but I don't know that they made contact. Somehow, either the spotter warned Junior or he sensed. You see the left side? I don't see any damage.
John Kernan is with Tony Stewart.
And Tony's car is in the garage. The crew busy working on it. Tony, you're okay. What happened?
I just lost it down there. I mean, we're just racing hard out there. It was my fault. I just got down in there, and I don't know why I got loose. I hadn't been loose down there all day. It just, for some reason, got loose that one lap down there, and just crashed a bunch of people. I didn't mean to crash. It was my fault. I lost it.
Do you think there might have been any oil or anything out there on the racetrack?
I don't know. Like I said, I hadn't been loose in that spot all day, so it was a big surprise to me when it got loose there. So I don't know. I just want to apologize to the guys I took out also.
Tony Stewart sitting here patiently watching as his team tries to fix his car as best they can and then get it back out on the racetrack.
Guys. Hey, John, you know, ironically, the only guy that he took out was Jeff Gordon. And he said the guys that I took out, really, truly, the only guy was Jeff Gordon.
And here comes Jeff back out on the racetrack already. Jeff Gordon has the best average finish of any driver here, 5.1, but he and Tony Stewart have been involved in a collision here early in the Pepsi 400.
Ready? Green, green, green.
Race underway once again on lap number 42. We ran four laps of caution with that Tony Stewart and Jeff Gordon incident down in turn one, but now speeds come up and we're back to competition. Both Bobby Labonte and Dale Earnhardt Jr. go to the inside of Rusty Wallace down the backstretch.
Well, I saw Johnny Benson drive to the bottom of the racetrack.
Whoa.
And there he is on the inside of Dale Earnhardt. Going in the corner, right behind Labonte.
Labonte had to back off. He got third. His car got loose down that inside once again, so he just had to back off.
And somehow Nadeau sneaked between Earnhardt and Jeff Burton. Meanwhile, Earnhardt is in the middle of a three wide. Jarrett's on the bottom of the racetrack.
Benson and Dale Earnhardt Jr.
Clear.
Now battle for third, but Benson falls behind, Little E.
At the 17 car, the DeWalt car. I talked to Robbie Reiser. The crew chief on that car, they changed everything possible to change on that car that has anything at all remotely to do with the chassis this morning. They said they were absolutely terrible in happy hour yesterday afternoon, and this morning he was shaking his head, and I just don't understand it. Right now, it looks like he does understand it because he's moved up to the 10th position.
Matt started in the 28th spot. Here is Johnny Benson once again down to the low side of Dale Earnhardt Jr. in the battle for third spot, but Benson unable to take advantage.
Well, he's trying to make that low groove work for himself. He drives her down there again.
Again, this team will be called MBV next year, with Valvoline owning 50% of this team. Johnny Benson will remain behind the wheel. Benson, of course, is the home state favorite this weekend. He grew up in Grand Rapids, Michigan.
And it looks like those two tires that Rusty Wallace changed on that middle right Ford was not a bad move, because he's able to stay up for quite a few laps in front of Bobby Labonte.
Rusty Wallace has led more races and more laps than any other driver this year, and he adds to that total here this afternoon. This is the 14th race that he has led, and coming into this event, he had led 1,042 laps, and so far, today's led 16. Now Rudd to the inside of Benson, or right behind him at least.
Well, he tried to go down the inside, but there's just not much room there, but he did help to push Benson right on by Dale Earnhardt Jr.
Oh, and Rudd needs to go up the hill, but Junior was there.
Look at Jeff Burton.
Now, drafting does come into play on this racetrack. Not like you see at Daytona and Talladega, where they're going to run right on into the corners right on the bumper, but on the straightaways, they can definitely feel the effects of it.
That's what Ricky, what Todd Bodine was talking about this morning in the garage here, just how much, how important the lap was in his victory yesterday in the 250-mile NASCAR Busch Series race. That was James Ince, the crew chief for Johnny Benson, telling him, oh, and Earnhardt is up there with no man's land.
He's been running awfully high.
Let's get out to John Kernan, who's caught up with Jeff Gordon.
His crew is working on his car, trying to get him ready, get the brakes fixed to get back out there. Jeff, it looked like you needed maybe, what, two, three more feet to get by?
Probably more than that. I saw him get sideways, and I was either going to hit him in the door or in the bumper, and I don't know. You know, I think this tore my car up a little bit worse trying to go around him, you know, but he got loose and there wasn't anywhere for us to go. It's unfortunate, you know. We made a two-tire stop there and got the car back up there in good track position. It didn't start out too good there. Those guys, the two tires are pretty good, but then once we got going there a few laps, my car was pretty good.
No confrontation this time between you two. It was strictly coincidental, wasn't it?
Yeah. You know, I'm sure there's probably a lot of people that are wondering, you know, about what was going to happen with the 20 and the 24, and that had nothing to do with this weekend at all. You know, he was racing hard and looked like he just got real loose under the 8 car.
All right, Jeff Gordon is okay. Headed back to the garage area to check out the work being done on his car.
And we're watching Jimmy Spencer and Wally Dallenbach and Robert Presley.
Ricky Craven, the 40 car. Sterling Marlin is a pretty good run going. Ward Burton, the Caterpillar car, started ninth, but he is moving back. He's back now to the 27th position. That was Ward Burton telling Tommy Ball is too tight in the nose. In other words, think the front sliding across the racetrack. Labonte finally has got a run.
Well, Rusty's going to hang on to that outside. Let's see.
Well, I think Labonte's got it. No,
I don't think so. Bobby had to back off. He didn't have the line that he needed going into the turn. I'm sure his spotter kept telling him he's still there. He's still there. And it just did not let him get in the turn at the angle that he needed to, but he's going to try it again now going into turn three.
Some of our observers have noticed that Bobby Labonte at the end of the front stretch, he gets a great run off Rusty Wallace. Here, he gets a great run, but at the end of the front straightaway, he seems to run out of gear. I would imagine they've got a chip in there that kills the engine at a certain RPM, and it might be that Labonte, about right there, starts running into the rev limiter and can't carry it on down in the corner.
But I'm wondering, too, if he doesn't have to back off to keep the car from really getting loose when he goes, because we heard earlier that he was loose. In fact, we saw it when he was up under some cars earlier under Dale Earnhardt Jr. He was very loose also. So
this is a good three-car battle up there in front, and a good three-car battle going on here as Rudd Earnhardt Jr. and Earnhardt all slug it out, and Dale Jarrett joins in. Now this is fifth, sixth, seventh, and eighth, and ninth, Matt Kenseth. Goes
look
to
at
the
that move.
Low side of the racetrack.
Now he's been running high. Let's see how this is going to work out when he gets down here to the turn, down on the inside.
Three wide into the corner. Man,
he just drove her on in there.
Sure did.
Going to pass them all. Maybe his son is going to let him get back on the outside, but here comes Rudd back on the inside. This is the kind of racing we used to see here at Michigan, yep, back when you were doing it.
Yes. And you know, Dale Earnhardt in the three car probably would have pulled a slide job on almost every race driver on the racetrack right now, except that eight car.
Yeah, he was far enough out in front of us. Just as he started off the two, he could have slid up in front of him, but he could have killed the momentum of his son.
You see Mark Martin there, who has passed Matt Kenseth, and Martin moves up to ninth.
Now, Mark Martin has really come up through the pack. He made a pit stop during that last caution, so he has really got his Valvoline Ford to working.
He started restarted 22nd position and is now up to the ninth spot. So, yes, it's like Jimmy Finning and the crew has made some great changes to the Valvoline car.
Down to Jerry.
On that pit stop for Mark Martin on lap 38, Mark had been complaining the car was very, very tight. It came in, only took on two right side tires. They took wedge out. The car would turn in the corners. Obviously, from looking at the racetrack, Mark is much, much better than he was the first 37 laps of today.
And Johnny Benson has taken over second position from Bobby Labonte. So Benson now sets his sights on the leader, Rusty Wallace. More than a fourth of the race is over already. Average speed is right up there, a near record. It's Rusty Wallace and Johnny Benson leading over Bobby Labonte. ESPN's coverage of the Pepsi 400 from Michigan Speedway is being brought to you by Kmart, Route 66. Jeans, clothes, it's not Main Street, only at Kmart. By Team Monte Carlo, the cars more champions depend on. Chevy will be there. And by Conseco. And the Conseco Pontiac, which started in third position, has fallen back to 22nd spot. Meanwhile, here is the battle up front. Johnny Benson challenging Rusty Wallace, but look at Jeff Burton out of nowhere.
99 inside.
Ricky Craven has taken his car to the pits, and we might tell you that Tony Stewart is officially out of the race. He had top 10 finishes, including three wins in the last 12 races, but is an early retiree here at Michigan.
Now this side-by-side battle for second is allowing Rusty Wallace to open up a little bit of a gap. Johnny Benson still on that inside.
inside, inside.
Here's DJ and Matt Kenseth trying to draft by Dale Earnhardt, but Earnhardt's been using that high groove. And he's going to make it work for himself again, it looks like.
Jeff Burton is on the outside of Rusty Wallace. That means one thing, trouble for Rusty Wallace. But can he out horsepower? Can he move up in front? He did. Man, that two car seems to have great horsepower. Meanwhile, Bobby Labonte's trying to take over that third spot from the 10 car. Johnny Benson, and does.
Jerry Nadeau and Dale Earnhardt now battle for the eighth spot. And here comes Matt Kenseth. Meanwhile, these four cars up front continue to slug it out. But nobody has been able to dispose of Rusty Wallace recently. Down to Jerry.
Guys, back in June, we watched the race here in Michigan, and we polled the top four or five finishers, and they said that they were turning about 8,400 to 8,550 RPM during that race. Well, for some reason here in August, the speeds are up considerably, and just before the race, I asked the 99 car, the 2 car, and a couple others how many RPMs on race day setup. They said between 8,900 and 9,100 RPMs. And guys, that's a lot for an engine to stand here for 400 miles. Let's check in with Bill Weber.
Well, Bobby Labonte out on the racetrack. And Benny, you speculated that perhaps there's a rev limiter chip in that 18 car as the 2 and the 99 continue to battle in front of the 18 on the racetrack. That's not the case. I talked to Mark Cronquist. He's the head engine builder for Joe Gibbs Racing and the engine tuner on the 18. He says at the end of the straightaways, they are simply getting out horsepowered, out muscled, because right now other teams can push their motors to the edge, trying to get that extra horsepower. But the 18 team needs the points. They need reliability, so they've opted for reliability over muscle at the end of the straightaways. Right now, they could use a little handling. Bobby Labonte moves all the way through the corners.
Finally, Jeff Burton is able to get into the lead. Now, Bobby Labonte comes up and challenges Rusty for second spot.
And we can see that high groove, just how much better it works. And as they go through the corner and both those cars go by Rusty Wallace. Also, we have to remember, Rusty Wallace still has those left side tires that he started the race on.
Jeff Burton, Jerry, becomes our fourth different leader today.
And guys, you may want to file it away. Jeff Burton, early on in the run, is not very good. But as after 30, 35 laps, he gets better. Caution.
Elliott Sadler, who had a horrible crash here in the spring, has crashed again here at Michigan Speedway, and will bring out our fourth caution of the afternoon.
And I tell you what, this crash might hurt worse than the one he had in the spring, because he flipped in practice during the June race, but looks like he's made just some terrific contact with the wall with the right side. And we see him talking to the crew on the radio. His left hand is pushing the button down as he talks to the crew.
We'll take a look at it from his onboard camera.
Very back of the screen, you see Elliott go up, and there he pounds the wall, and it looked like the tire went flat, that he ran over something, punctured a tire, and goes down the corner, and the front tire is flat, so it just will not turn. You see debris flying off the car.
Pace car has the field in tow, and so the pit road will open this time. And we'll see a lot of activity on pit road again as Jeff Burton leads Labonte and Wallace, Benson, and Ricky Rudd down.
This is the most exciting part. Guys down the pits can do their job. John Kernan.
And a
among the top four. Johnny Bensel will be the first to hit his pit stall. The James Insulet crew goes to work. They will make a chassis adjustment on the right rear, a half a round wedge out. Also an air pressure adjustment. And now let's go to Dr. Jerry Punch.
Triple split pits. Burton, Labonte, and Wallace head over to the 99, 18 and 2. Left side tires are going on the 99 car. Likewise, left side already up for Rusty Wallace. Let's check in with Bill Weber down in Bobby Labonte's pit.
14.51 on their last stop. Track bar adjustment, air pressure adjustment. Bobby Labonte on his way. He'll beat everybody out. The 88 and the 28 battle. The 22 jumps in the mix with his brother. Look out.
And Mike Skinner's car is still. They're making some huge, they're hooking up the rear sway bar. I would guess that they're hooking up the rear sway bar to try to free the car up. And they decided to give away all the track position for a better handling race car.
Mike Skinner was in 15th position, but will now fall back to the tail of the field as he completes the work on pit road and rejoins the field. We'll take a break and be right back. Michael Andretti is the car points leader. We'll try to stop the domination of Team Penske drivers Emilio Castroneves and Gilles Deferrin, who finished 1-2 last week at Mid-Ohio. Team Penske looks to make it 3-for-3 on permanent road courses this afternoon as the CART FedEx Championship Series is at the Motorola 220 at Road America, Elkhart Lake, Wisconsin. Here in Michigan Speedway in the NASCAR Winston Cup race, we are 66 laps in, and Ted Musgrave did not stop that caution period, so he is the leader, and everybody else did make a pit stop. Bobby Labonte is lined up right behind him. We're in our fourth caution of the afternoon due to a crash involving Elliott Sadler. We'll be right back. Back at Michigan Speedway, Ted Musgrave did make the pit stop, as you saw, just as we went to break. So he relinquishes the lead to Bobby Labonte once again. Bill Weber.
During the first round of pit stops for Bobby Labonte, Jeff Chandler, the front tire changer, felt a vibration in the socket of his air gun. You know how drivers feel a vibration? Well, Chandler felt one in this socket. They normally change them every three races. This socket was used at Indianapolis and Watkins Glen on the first stop here, 14.51. But after he felt that vibration, he took this socket off, put on a new one, second stop, 14.20, unofficially for the 18. Drivers feel vibrations, so do the tire changers. Let's go further down pit road.
And John Andretti has made multiple pit stops in the Cheerios Pontiac. John has complained the car is all over the racetrack, not consistent. The car goes in the corner, will not take a set, and then suddenly jerks to the right. Greg Stedman had made a couple of changes early on, but decided to bring the car down pit road, and they've actually moved the right rear of the car forward. That's why it was on pit road so long. John is down and away, but hoping it can do something to help this car. He said it is absolutely terrible.
And let's update you on Terry Labonte, who started last. His car was qualified by Todd Bodine. He started last, and Terry Labonte currently up to 22nd position, returning to the Winston Cup wars. Well, we thought we were going green this time around. We are not, so we'll run at least one more lap under caution. We'll take another break and be back with more in a moment at Michigan. Once again, we get back just as the green comes out and the crowd rises to its feet again. This green coming out on lap number 71.
Ricky Brendan in the 50 car has had numerous pit stops, and one of those pit stops has lost a lap.
They stopped under green a while back, and that did cost him a lap. He's the only car that's on the racetrack that is one lap down.
And those not on the racetrack include Jeff Gordon, who is still trying to fix his car. Tony Stewart is out. Brett Bodine is out. And so is Kerry Earnhardt. Well,
Dale Jarrett would like very much to get 5 bonus points to help his drive for the championship. He gets down to the inside of Bobby Labonte. They race side by side, coming to the line. And looks like Labonte's going to hold him off, at least for this lap. Ricky Rudd is right in behind Dale and perhaps giving him the push that he needs to get by.
Yes, he did. And he goes, slides up the racetrack. Right in front of Jarrett, but is Rudd going to take the deep before he gets back to the line?
Well, we're going to go 3 deep here. Well, maybe not. Rusty looked like he was going to go on the inside of Rudd. But now Rudd might be the man that will get the lead. Depends on how that outside group. Here comes Rusty. He might be the man that will get it.
Wow, look at this. 3 deep coming off the corner.
Well, let's see who's going to be when we get to the line. Rusty.
Yep. By just a few inches. Dale Jarrett has 6 straight top 5s here in Michigan. The last 2 races, he has finished 4th. And Dale Earnhardt Jr. begins to move up once again.
That's a 50 car. Richard Fraser came to similar to Earnhardt Jr.'s car. Earnhardt Jr. is back in 13th position right now.
Trying to move up.
Mark Martin, Johnny Benson, and once again, Matt Kenseth. We always talk about a wide racetrack and you can run so many places. That was clear evidence. You can run about any place you want to on this racetrack.
Yep. Last week's winner, Steve Park, comes up and joins the lead group. And that one car, he's been slowly moving up through the field.
Last time by, he was shown in 10th spot. He started 15th, but remember on that first caution flag, on lap 2 or something, made pit stop, made some serious adjustments to the car, went back to about 30th. He's now up to 10th, as I just said.
We can now list the 21 car of Elliott Sadler officially out of the race. Dale Jarrett's car is really pushing up coming off the 2. The last time he caused a big jam up over there when he went to the wall, and this time pushed up again for him.
Ward Burton and Mark Martin get by DJ. Here comes Johnny Benson and 17 of Matt Kenseth.
Looks like Mark Martin's going to take that spot away from Ward Burton. Move into 4th spot.
And Johnny Benson down to the low side of Ward Burton.
And Ward Burton only changed 2 tires this last pit stop, trying to get some of that track position he had lost, and it worked. But now is the car handling well enough?
You guys thought I had mistaken the 8 for the 50, but I was just watching Dale Earnhardt Jr. back in the pack moving up, and there's evidence that he is.
Yeah, you're right, Bobby. He's moving up to there.
They're done out of wreck there on turn 2.
Once again, he and his father are running right together on the racetrack.
Oh, Junior had to ease out of the throttle. Hear him off the corner when he eased out of the throttle. And Dolan's back. The green car on the inside. Yeah. Drives down to the inside of Earnhardt.
Had to make a return visit to pit road, BP, because, we kept Craven in the wall. I was going to say,
Dolan wall behind you.
Made a return visit to pit road because of a loose lug nut, and he has been able to move up through the field and now runs 13th. This
Position.
And you know what happened to Ricky Rudd? I believe he was just simply trying to get out of the way and let these guys race. Ricky Craven, man.
Wallace crosses the line as the leader, and the caution comes out for the 5th time this afternoon. Let's take a look at what happened to Ricky Craven as the car went up toward the wall in turn 1.
There he goes down the corner, and the someone right behind him, and it looked like he was trying to get out of the way and just simply got too high. That was Elliott behind him. He got in the loose stuff, and he wouldn't turn once he got up there.
The pace once again slowed because of a caution. 77 laps are completed in the Pepsi 400. Top 5, Wallace, Rudd, Bobby Labonte, Martin, and Benson. Onward at anticipating pit stops, but those drivers who were having problems with handling of their cars are on pit road, now beginning to move out on the racetrack once again.
And Dale Jarrett is still sitting on pit road work, and look at the crank on that thing, the chassis adjustment.
Yeah, I think they must have taken the rubber out and put one in or something on the right side.
Jerry?
Well, they were going to go two rounds up on the track bar and change four tires. They were trying to get a rubber out of the right rear, I guess. And I heard Todd say, don't worry about it. Just, if you can't get it out, put the tire back on. We'll check the left side tire. So I guess they were trying to get a rubber out of the right rear. But that's one of the reasons that Dale Jarrett pitted and some of the other leaders did not. These guys that pitted a moment ago were not at all happy with the way their cars are performing. Let's check in up pit road with John Kernan.
Rick Mast, who started third, dropped all the way back toward the end of the field on this last run. The caution coming out was a lucky break for them because he thinks he might have had an equalized tire because the car was vibrating so much that it was just rattling his teeth. So they were able to come in, take on four new tires. They're now checking out just to see exactly what might have been the problem. So as soon as I get an update on that, I'll let you know.
Well, it's one thing to run 200 miles an hour here at Michigan Speedway. It is quite another to run 50 miles an hour downhill on a sled racing six wide in the Supermass Street Luge. The finals are coming up today on ESPN. The finals of the Supermass Street Luge, part of the X Games. That's coming up next here on ESPN.
Man, they knock each other out of the way just like they do in stock cars, don't they?
That's a fun thing to watch. Ricky Craven's crew working on the pancaked right side of his car.
And Dale Earnhardt Jr. and Dale Jarrett both coming back into the pits. They were in the last lap.
Let's go down to Jerry Punch.
Well, they wanted to both come back in and make a mild adjustment. They're going to put some tape on the front of Little E's car while Dale Jarrett is hopefully going to be able to get that rubber out of the right rear. Now, they have a pair of vice grips. They're going to reach in there. They got the right rear tire off and try to yank and pull. A rubber spacer actually increases the rate of the spring and makes the right rear stiffer. If they pull it out, it will soften the right rear. They're going to maybe need a ratchet wrench to try to basically adjust and take some of the pressure off. They will. Well, they don't have time. Now, yes, they did get it out, so they're going to try to put the tire back on. So Dale Jarrett will be down on the way just a moment ago. Dale Earnhardt Jr. exited pit. That's putting more tape on the front of his car to try to get some more downforce on the nose. Now left side tires, and they will try to pull a rubber out of the left rear of Dale Jarrett's car. So obviously the car not up to his liking, and as Todd Parrott said a moment ago when the caution came out, the leaders may stay out, DJ, but we're not good enough to win. We have to pit and work on it, and indeed they have done that twice.
So Dale Jarrett will lose significant track position. A.J. Foyt looks on in the Pepsi 400 back in a moment. Here we go once again. Dale Jarrett drops all the way back to 36th position, and Jeff Gordon has rejoined the race. He is 42 laps down after getting extensive repairs on the DuPont Chevy.
Back there to Kodak Film Chevrolet, starting in 41st position as he goes by the 77 car of Robert Presley.
Hamilton finished last in June, completing only 16 laps. Much better run for Bobby here today.
Oh, baby, if you see a car that looks unfamiliar to you, that one, that green or lime colored 96, that's Andy Houston. He's driving a second Cal Wells car here. And this is maybe an audition to see who will drive the McDonald's team car in the year 2001.
His first ever NASCAR Winston Cup race.
Veteran NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series has two wins this year in truck competition at Homestead and Portland. 13 top 10 finishes this year for Andy. Michael Waltrip way up high on the racetrack. Once again, we see Dale Earnhardt carving his way through the field. He is at the 23rd position, and his teammate Mike Skinner is right behind him at a three wide in turn three.
Jared Mayfield backed out. He decided that would not be smart to drive into that deep going into that turn down the inside. It might be like Tony Stewart. Back in, get out from under.
See, Chad Lildon on the inside, the John Deere car. On the inside of Michael Walton, they're three wide. Mikey does not want to be there, so he, ooh, and Earnhardt just turns left in front of him and goes in the middle of a three-wide situation.
Kevin LePage is working the bottom of the track at the number 16 familyclick.com, and for just a moment, it looked like they could go four wide back there.
Last lap, Mike Skinner was right behind Dale Earnhardt as we ride along with Skinner. Ooh, and you can see that they made some serious adjustments on Mike Skinner's car, but I don't think he still likes it very much. It's not a very happy car right now.
Dale Jarrett coming up through the traffic. Again, he was 36 when the green flag came out to restart. Up to 31st right now.
Oh, look at this car. All of a sudden, Jarrett's car just goes up the racetrack violently. It's like that Musgrave in the 0-1 pulled in behind him and got him extremely loose. Mike Bliss, the 27 car. Jarrett goes by him, but Earnhardt Jr. can't make that move on the inside.
Jimmy Spencer, Jeff Burton, Bobby Hamilton, and Bill Elliott running right together on the racetrack. 9th, 10th, 11th, and 12th.
40 cars. Sterling Marlin is on the left. See, you didn't believe me. The director had to put the camera up so you could see Sterling Marlin now being passed by Wally Dallenbach. Great run today for that red cell car.
Yep.
Well, I thought Dallenbach had passed him, but here comes Sterling Marlin back on the inside.
Boy, it's interesting the variety of brews that they're using. Just some on the high, low, and just searching all over the place for a comfortable spot.
This is Wally Dallenbach's 16th race here at Michigan. His best finish was in August of 98. He came home 8th in the spring race. In June here, he started 24th and finished 34th. He and Bill Elliott, the track's winningest active driver with 7 victories, are side by side. And a lot of traffic. Here's Kenny Wallace alongside DJ.
Oh, Robbie Gordon gets the big wiggle in that 13 car. As he tries to get down in the corner, and that's, Skinner tried to go in the middle of this on the inside of Gordon. All of a sudden, Kenny Wallace was where he intended to be.
Robbie Gordon did not qualify well on Friday, but he elected not to requalify on Saturday in second round, and what he did was watch everybody who were out of provisionals fail to make the race, and that gave Robbie the 43rd and final starting position.
Meanwhile, Dale Jr. Talk about track position and how these teams fight for track position. There we see the A car, Dale Earnhardt Jr., back in 33rd spot. As strong as he was earlier on, he's struggling to try to pass these cars back in the 33rd spot, because anymore in NASCAR West Cup Racing, track position seems to be the key.
That's Dave Blaney up ahead.
And Blaney loses a couple of spots to Junior and Joe Nemechek.
Junior's tried both the low and the high side. He goes low this time on the inside of Robbie Gordon, but his car is still not working the way that it looked like it was at the beginning of the race. But there again, being in track position probably had a lot to do with that. When he was out front, it was much easier to do it when he was back in the pack.
It looks like Junior right now needs the entire racetrack. Looks like if he could go in and then let the car go up to the top of the racetrack, he might be okay. But there are other cars up there, and since he can't do that, it seems to really hinder his progress.
Less than 10 laps away from the halfway point, Rusty Wallace leads, but by just a couple of car lengths over Ricky Rudd. Then we get back to the third place car. Bobby Labonte is about a 1.7 seconds behind. And behind Bobby Labonte running in fourth position is Johnny Benson. We'll check the speeds here as they hit the line and see who's the best. Right now with the top speed at 180.243 while everybody else is in the 170s.
miles per hour, about 40 seconds flat around this racetrack.
Once again, here comes Wally Dallenbach,
trying to take over the 10th spot from Jeff Burton.
Dallenbach had a good happy hour, and we get more from Bill Weber.
Well, having a real good run here, especially since they pitted and the race went green back on lap 81. The thing about it is, I'm told by the crew, Wally's been good on the track most of the day. They've just had problems on pit road. Last time, it was a two-tire stop and fuel, small air pressure adjustment. Wally Dallenbach, perhaps a secret today.
He's coming off his best finish of the year. Last weekend at Watkins Glen, he finished ninth after leading two laps. Dallenbach led three laps and finished 23rd in the first race here at Michigan. He's driving the same car that he competed in at the Brickyard 400. You can see Tony Stewart there in our Napa field summary. You see how he is losing positions in the point standings. Tony Stewart is already out of the race. He will be finishing in about 41st position, out early in a crash. Ricky Rudd continues to chase Rusty Wallace. Wallace has led the most laps so far in this event, 58 of the first 95. Bobby Labonte has led 19. Dale Earnhardt Jr. has led 13. Jeff Burton was up front for three laps, and Ted Musgrave led a lap a little bit ago. Welcome back to ESPN's live coverage of the Pepsi 400 presented by Craftsman Tools at Michigan Speedway. We are at the halfway point, just about to complete 100 laps, and we do have a new leader. Ricky Rudd is now in front of Rusty Wallace.
Comes off turn four, gets on the inside of Rusty Wallace. Now, we've seen Rusty use horsepower all day long to stay in front, but this time he could not stay in front of Ricky Rudd as he just goes down in the corner and powers by Rusty.
Now, as they come to the stripe, they get the crossed flags. We are at the halfway point. There is Bobby Labonte, who's running in third position, about 2.5 seconds behind Ricky Rudd. Fourth place car is Johnny Benson. Then the 17 of Matt Kenseth, the leading rookie, as far as points are concerned, is in fifth position. Here comes Matt in the DeWalt Tools Ford.
Last week's winner, Steve Park, is back in the sixth position.
And John Curtin has an update on Matt Kenseth.
You can't blame Matt Kenseth if he thinks that the car that he's driving is his favorite car. After all, the last time that he raced in that car, it was at Charlotte in the Coca-Cola 600, where he picked up his first career NASCAR Winston Cup victory. Now, yesterday morning after practice, he was very happy with the way the car was, but in the afternoon happy hour session, he wasn't that happy, so they made some changes, and so far today, it looks like they've made the right moves because he's running pretty well.
The sixth caution of the day is coming out, this one for Hut Strickland.
Looked like the engine let go, Bob. A lot of smoke coming from the Hills Brothers, car number 90.
And it looked like a big-time engine blow.
Hutt was the fastest second round qualifier.
All right, now with Next time they come by, they will complete 102 laps before they can pit. It will be 103. That just might take the fuel situation strategy out of the race today, because then the teams would only have to run 48, 49 laps, and I think most of them can do that.
Yeah, after they make this pit stop, when pits are open, they'll have one more that they'll need to make as far as fuel is concerned.
Pennzoil Copter Cam has the overhead shot for you as the cars are behind the pace car going down the backstretch.
There's still 36 cars on the lead lap.
Wow. So if you have a problem now and just lose one lap, you could go from a top five car back to 36 spot.
Mm-hmm.
Jeff Gordon is the only car out there that is on the racetrack and not on the lead lap. Everybody else is either out of the race or behind the wall.
Now it's time for the pit crew for that adrenaline to start flowing as you get ready to see who's going to win this battle off pit road. Four tires, fuel. I know I can do it faster than that next guy. Right, John?
That's exactly right. Johnny Benson just told his crew, guys, let's have a smooth one and see if you can pick me up some spots here on pit road. It'll be a four-tire change, a wedge adjustment in the right rear, as the tire codes on these tires are different from the ones that came off the car. So James Hitt says they had to make a chassis adjustment to compensate for that. Now the Dr. Jerry punches the let's go on Johnny's car.
Ricky Rudd's car is as good as it's been all day long. They tear away the windshield, four-tire no adjustments. Rudd is down and away. Here goes Rusty Wallace. It's 55 miles an hour, and Rudd will beat Wallace. Let's go down to Bell Weber.
Track bar adjustment, four tires for Bobby Labonte and a mad dash off of him.
Steve Park picked up three spots with a good stop.
They did that last week. Remember last week, yep. He took the lead with a terrific pit stop.
The only car besides Jeff Gordon who did not pit, John Andretti. He elected to stay out, but everybody else was on pit road, and now everybody is off pit road, as we will be right back. Back at Michigan Speedway, John Andretti is the leader of the race. He has chosen not to pit during this caution period, or at least not yet. Lined up behind him is Ricky Rudd and then Rusty Wallace. Steve Park up to fourth.
John had nothing to lose. He was running right near the end of the pack, and so why not lead a couple of laps here and get those five bonus points? You only need to lead one to do that, but get a little bit of airtime here as well.
Just past the halfway point, Dale Earnhardt Jr., who was the Bud Pole winner here at Michigan, is running in 18th position. There you see the drivers that are eligible for the 2001 Bud Shootout at Daytona. Now, this was the second Bud Pole for Dale Earnhardt Jr. He won the pole in May at the Coca-Cola 600 at Lowe's Motor Speedway. Another quick break. We'll be right back with more live action from Michigan. ESPN's coverage of the Pepsi 400 from Michigan Speedway is being brought to you by Sonic, America's drive-in. By Budweiser, with the crisp, clean, refreshing taste you'll find in no other beer. This Bud's for you. And by Penske Auto Centers, featuring Speedlane 1999 oil change done in 30 minutes, or it's free. Well, John Andretti has made his pit stop, and so Ricky Rudd is back at the front of the field. And a Coke pit summary shows you that he maintained his position. So did Rusty Wallace. Steve Park moved up one. Bobby Labonte down one. And Jimmy Spencer, who was running in 18th position when the caution came out, gained significant track position up to fifth.
And Ricky Rudd, as you see, in first, out in first. And look, the crew, I talked about adrenaline and making his pit stop. They come around the left side. All right, the left side's up. Jim taking the windshield piece of plastic off. Watch the crew. They watch it, the race down pit road. All right, guys, we did it. We came out in first.
sometimes you have to go beyond working on the car to make sure everything is in good working order.
So what we're doing here now?
Apparently, we have a broken fly on Robert Yates' pants, but it's fixed now, Doc.
Well, apparently, Robert Yates said he wears these pants on Sundays. He said he loves these pair of pants, but apparently the zipper continues to work its way down, and when he's making a pit stop, he continues to expose himself to the guys over the wall. So the guy said, enough's enough. We're going to put tape on the front of Robert. And Robert said, we're changing it to black tape to match the car. Robert said, the only concern I have is it may overheat a little bit, but then again, I haven't overheated in a long, long time, so it may feel pretty good. But they're having some fun here. Obviously, they're running awfully well. They can laugh and have some fun here at Michigan in the Ricky Rudd pits.
I'm not sure if this is the appropriate place to mention this, Jerry, but today is Jerry Punch's birthday. Happy birthday to the doctor.
Wow. Happy birthday, Doc.
Thanks, Bob. Thank you, guys. Appreciate it.
I asked him how old he was. He said 23. Yeah, he probably is, and I don't know how many years besides that. They're the top five under caution. The Pepsi 400 presented by Craftsman Tools just about set to go back to racing as the pace car accelerates and hits pit road. And here comes Ricky Rudd and the rest ready to stamp on the accelerator and get this thing underway once again.
Spencer just about to lose a spot as Kenseth down the road just turns left, tries to get alongside. He does. Can he take that spot away? Meanwhile, how did Jimmy Spencer get up there, John Kernan?
Well, Vinny, you know these crews all work hard on their pit stops. Spencer's car has been good. The pit stops have been, well, maybe even better. That last one, four tires, a minor air pressure adjustment because the car is pretty good. But they did it in 15.1 seconds. So now they have Jimmy up in the top 10. Let's see what he can do with the race car.
Great side-by-side battle up front. I think Rudd perhaps got credit for leading that lap, but now Rusty retakes the lead.
Well, here comes Rudd back on the inside. He's going to triple it, but it wasn't going to work. Behind him, they're three wide.
Matt Kenseth is up to fourth. Behind him, again, they are three wide there with Benson, Hart, and Spencer, and Mark Martin all doing battle.
Steve Park restarted in third spot, but right now he just cannot hold it. He's falling back to about the 7th, 8th position. And James Enns talking to Johnny Benson.
Come outside.
Then the Mark was back there if he wanted to try to use that draft and stay low. Here occasionally, Vic McGuire. Wallen dialing back, having a great battle. That's a green car on the inside of Earnhardt going down in one.
That was Martin that had contact with Earnhardt, wasn't it? Ned over there in two?
I think so. Yeah.
Dialing back just slides uphill in front of Earnhardt.
Good job.
You can say that in about 30 laps, it will be a good job.
Yeah. DJ's working using that low groove after they took those spring rubbers out of his car and lost that track position. He started working the inside, and really, he came up to 15th from 33rd that time, Bob, and the car seems to be working good down on the inside.
Mark Martin, meanwhile, loses a position to Wally Dahlenbach, or there for a moment. Dahlenbach gets a little loose there in the corner. Martin to challenge back on the outside, but a good battle here between Martin and Dahlenbach for the 10th position.
That was really a good shot back in the corner of Earnhardt, as high as you go in the corner, and Jarrett as low as you can go in the corner.
Oh, look at DJ down low.
And look at Earnhardt up high. Wow. Earnhardt, that cost him a little bit that time.
He got in there and could not get back on the accelerator the way that he should and lost some time.
Lost about four spots, too. had to back off the gas a little bit, I guess. Earnhardt we're talking about. The three car. And up there again, here's his son, Dale Jr., down on the inside.
Hamilton running alongside Jarrett.
Danny Gill's been doing a pretty good job. Danny Gill, the new crew chief in the four car. Very nice young man out of Nashville, Tennessee. Bobby brought him up from the NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series and said, you are my crew chief.
Boy, look at him go down on the inside. Hamilton just picked up a couple of positions there. Just
John Kernan has more on Bobby Hamilton.
That is a brand new car for Bobby Hamilton this weekend, seeing its first race action. And they thought they got a big scare, actually, on lap 65. They thought they had a right rear shock going bad. That's the same thing that put them out of contention back at this track in June. So they pitted under caution, made some air pressure adjustments, some chassis adjustments, and that fixed the problem. So it wasn't a right rear shock going bad. It was just the chassis was off a little bit. And ever since they've made that change back around lap 65, the four car has been flying.
Overall, though, the 2000 season has not been a good one for Bobby Hamilton. He is 17 positions lower in the point standings now than he was at this time last year. The greatest drop of any driver. He was 13th in the point standings a year ago and is currently in 30th spot. And Jimmy Spencer also drifts up high.
Yeah, he lost five or six spots in that one corner because we talk about happy cars and unhappy cars. His car was very unhappy around all that traffic. He just could not get back the accelerator.
Dale Earnhardt Jr. now to the inside of Jarrett. And again, we see father and son together on the racetrack.
Finger down low, head up high.
It's kind of squeezed in between Jarrett and his dad. See Ken Schrader trying to go on the outside of DJ.
Last lap around, DJ went on the high groove in turns three and four. He'd been working so low down there before that cost him. Here's a change for the lead, maybe.
Rudd gets credit for leading the lap.
Rusty coming back on the outside.
Oh! Contact! And whoa!
Can he save it?
Oh. Man, oh, man.
What a job by Rusty Wallace.
He did, really did do a great job because that thing had all of the inclinations of a crash.
But it broke his momentum, and he loses second now to Bobby Labonte.
And he finally took a breath about right there.
Wow, great job by both he and Ricky Rudd.
I remember a couple of years ago that Rusty and Dale Earnhardt had a happy hour situation where they got together and wrecked. Something very similar to that.
Now, Rusty trying to get that second position back.
And we'll do so. Here it is again. Watch the contact between Rudd and Wallace.
Right there is the contact. Rusty's car goes up the hill, he had to chase it, and he caught it just in time.
Boy, he did a great job.
That last time around, Rusty was just a little bit faster than Rudd.
Hey, check this out, Andy Houston had 96 cars, moved up to the 16th position.
Audition going pretty well here today.
It is.
But see that 12 car back there? He's got a little bit of a surprise today. I would have thought Jeremy would have been better. He was so good here in June, and in the early part of the race, he was good. But since then, the car just doesn't seem to be like it.
Jeremy trying to take 19th away from Dave Blaney. And Kenny Schrader. Benson takes the fourth position away from Matt Kenseth. the lead that Ricky Rudd has on Rusty Wallace. It is 85 hundredths of a second. 120 laps completed here at Michigan Speedway. Back in a moment. Our seventh caution is waving over Michigan Speedway as Bill Elliott has made contact with the wall over in turn number two. The car is still up against the wall. There is the crew watching.
Dejected look on their face. It's understandable.
And also concern for the driver because this is, well, now, guys, watch the monitor because you'll see your driver moving around, disconnecting his helmet. It's always good news to see.
Elliott will not add to his win list here at Michigan today. He has been a seven-time winner here at this facility. This car is called Hot Rod Harry, and it ran here in Michigan earlier this year, also in Indianapolis. They got to repair Hot Rod Harry here in the next few weeks.
If they can.
Yeah. Jerry, what happened?
Well, I'm not sure anyone really knows, quite honestly, but Bill Elliott thinks that he may have cut a right front tire going into the corner. He felt the right front of the car give on him, and he's telling the crew he thinks he may have just run over something, or anyway, the right front tire went down, so he went up into the wall as we get set for pit stops here during this caution flag.
We'll show you the replay in just a moment. Meanwhile, we're going to watch these pit stops. By the way, the last time Elliott DNF'd was in 1981 here at Michigan. John?
And Johnny Benson's crew will go to work before tire change. They'll take a half rubber out of the right front. Johnny says, I think we do that, we can win this race. To Dr. Jerry Punch.
Expecting two right side tires on the Rusty Wallace, and that's all they took. Two right side tires, air pressure change. Let's check in with Bill Weber.
Bobby Labonte wants the car to rotate better in the turns. The 2 and the 99 go by. The 10 is also away, so is the 6. A half pound adjustment to the right side and the left side tires for Bobby Labonte. Have to stop at least one more time.
How about that Andy Houston? I guess they changed two tires, and he gets a lot of traction. And Steve Park is still in as they make some major chassis adjustments on that car, trying to fix the car.
Yeah, he was dropping back a little bit out on the racetrack, and I'm sure he welcomed this caution flag to come in and make some adjustments on his Kenzel Chevrolet.
Now we're going to jump on board the Bill Elliott car with his onboard camera and see if we can listen and determine what happened.
Sounded like that right front tire went down as he got into turn between 1 and 2. Rides that wall all the way off of turn 2.
And about right now, he takes a breath because, folks, when you hit that wall, it just all the air leaves your body and you gasp for a breath for about 30, 40 seconds.
75 laps to go here at the Michigan Speedway. It is Ricky Rudd leading the Pepsi 400. Welcome back to Michigan Speedway, Brooklyn, Michigan, in the Irish Hills of the southern part of that state. And we are one lap away from getting this Pepsi 400 restarted. Well, the X Games are underway in San Francisco, and although the athletes there are a little bit younger than here, the themes are basically the same. On the pier in the city by the bay is Chris Fowler. Chris?
Thanks, Bob. Today at the X Games in San Francisco, speed is the theme with the Street Luge Supermass competition. 6 sleds on the Seal Rock Run course, speeds of over 50 miles an hour. This is full contact racing. The X Games immediately following the Pepsi 400. Bob?
Full contact racing at 50 miles an hour on your back. Huh?
On your back, man.
Down to Jerry Punch.
Guys, updating a couple pit stops down where we are. Jeff Burton came in for 2 right side tires only. And again, his car, his problem is the car gets tighter and gets tighter and tighter throughout the run. They made an air pressure change to try to loosen the car up and free him up a little bit after that 2 right side tire change. Now, Ricky Rudd came down. Remember, from lap 64, Rudd said the car's been perfect. They haven't touched it. They put 4 tires on and cleaned the windshield, put gas in it, but no change whatsoever to the chassis. Let's check in with Bill.
Tough break for Steve Park on that last pit stop. They ran so perfectly in the pits last week. On this last stop, they had a clutch problem. Basically, they got a little air in there. He had to pump the clutch. When that happened, it rolled forward off the jack, and that just killed him on their pit stop. They fall back to 30th, and we go to John.
Jerry Nadeau has been on pit road during this caution several times. They have made wholesale changes to the race car because it's very loose. They have moved the rear forward. They've added rubber to the right front. They've made air pressure adjustments, just about everything that you can imagine they have done to that race car. Jerry Nadeau rejoining the tail end of the field. Will hope to make his way toward the front, and we'll be back to Michigan in just a moment.
Flag once again as we restart the Pepsi 400. The green coming on lap number 130. Rusty Wallace is in the lead. Jeff Burton, then Mark Martin, Bobby Labonte, and Ricky Rudd. And running in sixth position is Andy Houston. And the last time a driver finished in the top 10 in his first race was Matt Kenseth in Dover of 98. He finished sixth. And Dale Jarrett is on the move.
Mike Skinner's moved up to the eighth position.
Well, he just lost it coming off of turn two as DJ and Kenseth got by. Drop Skinner down at the 11th now.
Meanwhile, here's Ricky Rudd trying to work that Texaco car back to the front.
This is going on. Rusty has checked out on it.
Bobby Labonte comes up and tries to push Mark Martin, and he does, gets by Ricky Rudd. Meanwhile, Houston got a challenge on the inside from Jeremy Mayfield.
Rusty's open up a 1.1 second advantage. Last time he ran a 183.7, and the next fastest was 181.3. Andy Houston started 35th on lap 26. He had fallen back to 37th, but has worked his way up into the top 10. He's sixth.
He's in there with some pretty heavy hitters right now.
Labonte dives to the inside of the track.
Ricky Rudd is Earnhardt and Benson and the 31 car all together as Benson trying to work his way back to the front. He was in fourth position on this caution flag and came out of pits in 16th.
Back up front. This is the battle for third. And Jarrett will take the position from Houston, moving DJ to sixth.
And Houston's going to go down and try to draft along the 88 car. See if he can keep up with the 1999 NASCAR Winston Cup champion.
They're Hickory, North Carolina neighbors. They live in the same town, Hickory, DJ, and Andy Houston.
Meanwhile, here comes Wally Dallenbach on the inside of Jeremy's room. Oh, he just squeezed right in front of Jeremy.
They've been some slide jumps on each other out there a little bit.
Dallin,
like a dirt track.
Dallenbach up to eighth spot. Now he dives on the inside of Houston. Hamilton trying to push the 75 car. Dallenbach by Houston.
Remember, Hamilton was really fast before this last caution. He had gone up through there past a lot of race cars, and he's passing a bunch of them.
Down to Jerry Punch, who has a report on tires.
Got
Guys, we have polled the top half a dozen teams, and what we are being told is that Goodyear has run completely out of right side tires. Now, most of the teams that I've talked to have at least one set, some have two sets, and one team has three sets. If we go green, there'll be one more pit stop lap around lap 175 to 180, and no one will have to worry about it. If we get multiple caution flags, it could be a bidding war for right sides here in the pits.
Looks like Dallenbach goes by and takes that spot away from Jeremy. Moves him up to the seventh position.
Ricky Craven, who hit the wall on lap 77, has replaced the front spindles and brakes and is back in competition. Ricky Craven rejoins the fight. Let's update the Bud Pole winner, Dale Earnhardt Jr. It's not been a good day for the pole sitter as he is back in 23rd position.
Once he got back in the pack, we talked about that earlier, it's been tough for him to pass a lot of race cars. As he left Johnny Benson's side up at the position there.
Matt Kenseth, the 17th driver, the DeWalt car has the 96 on the outside of the 96. Meanwhile, go back to the battle for second spot.
Ricky Rudd had a run on Labonte there a moment ago, trying to work it again, try to get another run. See, they're just a fraction faster than Rudd is than Bobby Labonte the last time by.
Rudd had the fastest lap of anybody that last lap. But the interval to the leader, Rusty Wallace, is 2.5 seconds.
That slow car you saw coming off turn two, pretty sure it was Ricky Craven.
It was.
Back up here to the battle for 10th, 11th, and 12th. That's Benson. He now comes up on Jeremy Mayfield. Kenseth running right behind Benson, then Hamilton, and then Houston.
And this race today, I think it's going to help Andy Houston a great deal. It's not going to help him as far as setting his truck up, and he goes back to the NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series, but it's going to give him a lot of confidence that he can. He is a great race car driver. Hey, after all, I ran right behind Bobby Hamilton, Matt Kenseth. I stayed in front of Dale Earnhardt. So it's going to happen a great deal as far as the middle part of the business.
Was there a generation before Tommy, or is Andy the second generation?
Andy's the second generation. Yeah. I don't know that their dad ever raced, but Tommy's older brother, Hal Houston, did race. He was Dale Earnhardt's father-in-law.
And Dale Earnhardt Jr., he is still back. Actually, he has just lost a position to Jimmy Spencer. So put Dale Earnhardt Jr. back in 24th now after a pole start. And look at how he has to chase the car up the racetrack.
Trying to find a search for a place that thing will work for him. He is struggling right now. He just drives it up there to try to get those right wheels up there in that gray stuff. And then, well, it's like somebody passed him.
Losing more spots as the 93 car and the 97 both have gone by.
Now, the 77 car down there on the apron of the racetrack is Robert Presley, who had an outstanding race here in June, almost won the race, finished in fifth. That's been his best finish of 2000. This is the same car that he drove here in Michigan in June. It also ran at California and at Charlotte.
If the rain had worked out just right for him, like it did with Tony Stewart, he would have won that race. But it didn't, unfortunately.
These guys are battling back for the 14th, 15th, 16th position, somewhere in there.
The
Joe Nemechek, the Oakwood Holmes car, down in the bottom of the racetrack.
He's one of those drivers who made a lot of pit stops during a couple of the caution flags and came out near the end of the pack, and now he's up there in the 18th position. Sterling Marlin moving around Ward Burton. That should be for the 14th position.
Joe finished 8th last week in Watkins Glen. 4th and 5th position. The 99 and 88, but up ahead of them, we see a change for second position as Ricky Rudd has taken over that position from Bobby Labonte.
Now, they were running about a little over 2 seconds behind Rusty Wallace. Rusty had run out there almost 2.5 seconds at one time, and they just gradually clipped away at that. Now that Rudd is in front of Labonte, it'll be interesting to see if he can run the two car of Rusty Wallace down. Now, these guys have been going at it for about 10 laps. DJ has been trying to test Jeff Burton on the low side. Here he'll try it again, but he hasn't made it work yet. Now, they're staying about the same distance. They're a little over 4 seconds behind Rusty Wallace, and they've been that way for about 7 or 8 laps.
Dale Jarrett has scored more points than any other driver in the last 6 races. His average finish, 5.6. And has finished in the top 10, including 2 wins in the last 9 races here. Take that position away from Jeff Burton.
Now, I said that they were running about the same distance behind Rusty Wallace, which was a little 4 seconds. Well, I noticed that a scoring monitor has been locked in that for about 5 or 6 laps, so I'll have to put more trusty stopwatch to work here and just see how that is working now.
Benson and Mark Martin.
For the sixth position.
Yeah, Benson had just came up and took that away in the last couple of laps from Mark. And DJ and Jeff Burton are still running about the same distance behind Rusty Wallace that they were about 10 laps ago. Now, Mark Martin has dropped off. He was up there, but he has dropped off the pace a little bit. As you just saw, he lost that position to Johnny Benson.
Johnny Benson, you're 0.2 of a second faster than the leader. And for once, I'm not lying to you. I'm telling you the truth.
Rusty Wallace maintaining about a 2-second lead now on his closest competitor, which right now is Ricky Rudd, with Bobby Labonte, Jeff Burton, Dale Jarrett, and Mark Martin, the top six. Rusty Wallace has clinched the most laps led today here at Michigan, giving him 10 bonus points now for the day. He has led the most laps in 4 prior races this season before today. He has not won any of those.
And
his teammate, I'm sorry.
As big as anything, he gets $10,000 from Gatorade for leading the most laps.
His teammate Jeremy Mayfield runs in 10th spot. Bill Weber has more.
Well, Bob, Jeremy making his return today. He says he feels pretty good. He's recovered from the head injury he suffered in that practice crash at Indianapolis. Of course, he sat out Indian Watkins Glen. He returned today, but his neck, shoulder, and upper back muscles are still sore. This morning, he had to postpone a 10:30 interview with RPM Tonight so he could get those sore muscles massaged. Now, because those neck muscles are sore, Mayfield is wearing a helmet with no paint on it. It's primered like a test race car. Why? Because paint adds weight. How much weight depends on the design. Fancy paint schemes and sponsor logos add more weight, plus 2 or 3 applications of clear coat to protect. adds even more weight. If you think paint doesn't weigh anything, after the race, go out in the garage and just pick up a full pint. That's the weight that's on the helmet that your neck muscles have to support. But Jeremy Mayfield wearing a lighter helmet today when he makes his return to the track.
Wow, nice.
Interesting.
Very interesting, Bill. I had not thought of that.
There's Mayfield running with Wally Dallenbach. There's Andy Houston running with Dale Earnhardt.
Man, I'm telling you what. Dale Earnhardt was so high up in the corner, almost against the outside retaining wall. Andy Houston, I'm sure that he's impressing some people today. It's a terrific run he has going.
And it has to be a thrill for him to be running with, and in this case, in front of, such a veteran like Dale Earnhardt.
To move up on Nemechek. Luke Craven in and out the pitch again.
Now Bobby Hamilton and Mark Martin are side by side.
Well, Mark is going backwards. This car is just not. This set of tires is apparently not working for Mark because he was up there and in fifth position, fourth position actually, and now he's
lost the position to Hamilton. It is good to see Bobby Hamilton having a good run.
That's really faded is Wally Dallenbach. You see him now back behind Andy Houston. Watch Earnhardt just how high he goes this corner. As Nemechek goes to the bottom of the racetrack, and watch Earnhardt. Right up next to the outside retaining wall. I love it when the racetrack's like this, and a driver can find the groove that makes his car better, makes his car worse. He can hunt around, search around, and the driver becomes such a huge part of it.
This car right here, guys, is on the move. Jeff Burton has come from about 4.25 seconds to only about 3 seconds behind Rusty Wallace. He was the fastest car on the racetrack, according to my stopwatch here. It looked like in long runs that he is, so moving on.
And Andy Houston is off the pace after such an outstanding debut in his Winston Cup race. Now brings the car to the apron of the racetrack up in turns 3 and 4.
Well, he has a lot to be proud of here today, the way that he ran.
Jerry Nadeau is also on pit road. John Kernan is there.
Jerry Nadeau's crew make a chassis adjustment with wedge and put on 4 tires. The car very, very loose. Remember, they made all those changes on the last pit stop. They went out and Jerry told his crew, he said, hey, I feel like I'm running on dirt out here. I'm still loose.
And Andy Houston has taken his car into the garage area. There you see it, coasting in.
Also saw Chad Little on pit road, but up front, Ricky Rudd has caught. He is reeled in Rusty.
Yeah, he was 2 seconds behind there for a long time, and then he just started gradually picking him off a tenth of a second to lap, and here he is.
Did Rusty Wallace change 2 tires that last pit stop?
I think he did.
If that is the case, then maybe it's getting to the point now that these Ricky Rudd to changing 4 tires, it has become an advantage. Looks like it's going to be an advantage. It'll take him right to the front. He gets on the inside of Rusty, dive to the bottom, and
right to the bottom, right to the white line, but Wallace battles back.
Just drives it down in the corner, retakes the lead.
And Ricky didn't want to drive it on down there like he did before, which almost wrecked both of them.
by the way, we realize that we are not showing you the scoring up in the upper left corner of your screen as we do almost constantly. We are experiencing computer problems. Not only you at home there on the screen, but we are experiencing computer problems here in the booth. There's the 18 and the 99 running third and fourth, and both of those are right up against the wall. And again, Rudd will get credit for leading that lap. The question is, will he have it in turn one? And perhaps Wallace with a bit of a push there from Nadeau.
Nadeau just came out of the pits.
Jerry has more.
And Benny, to answer your question, yes, Rusty Wallace did indeed take only two right side tires on his last pit stop on lap 125. He's been fighting the cars, but a little bit tight on Austin, and continue to make air pressure changes in the right front and right rear. But those left side tires have been on the car number two since lap 104. So now some 56 laps in left side tires. Maybe that's showing a little bit now, because remember, Rudd made a four-tire change.
Jerry Nadeau has just unlapped himself with those fresh tires on the 25.
I'm told that the 96 car experienced a drop in oil pressure and somehow saw that, I guess, the engine started to tighten and he was able to turn it off before it blew up. Is that right, John Kernan?
That's exactly right, Benny. In fact, just got a little more information from the garage area. Andy told the crew, told us that the car shook really hard going into turn one. Then he lost power, of course, lost oil pressure. So an engine problem for Andy Houston, but he sure gave it a heck of a run, didn't he?
He sure did, John. He had a terrific run. And Jeff Burton still trying to get by Bobby Labonte for third spot. He's got a really fast race car, as Ned Jarrett just told you, and he's going to have one to catch Ricky Rudd, who just took the lead, as you saw the last lap.
Just a little less than 38 laps to go.
We should have green flag pit stops coming up before too long, if you have already made them.
And so while we prepare for those pit stops by those running up front, we'll take a break and be back with more of the Pepsi 400 presented by Craftsman Tools. ESPN's coverage of the Pepsi 400 from Michigan Speedway is being brought to you by Citgo. You'll love racing. We love racing. By Polaris ATVs. If you're going to ride, ride the best. Polaris. And by the Wide Track Pontiac Grand Prix, proud sponsor of the U.S. Olympic team. 165 laps completed here at Michigan with Ricky Rudd now showing the way. In fact, lengthening his lead over second place Rusty Wallace. The interval is about a second.
Once he got around, Rusty was able to pull away, and I suspect that those left side tires on Rusty's car have been on there for a long time, but he's paying the price for it right now.
And sometimes you always think about short pitting. In other words, stopping before you have to, or and putting on some new tires that will make the car go faster. And Ricky Rudd, I'm sure Rodney Pemberton, some guys right now are thinking about that. And if they want to stop, get these fresh tires on. Jerry, what are they saying down there?
Benny, you make a very valid point. Now, we expect the final scheduled pit stop for both the 2 and the 28 to come anytime in the next 7 or 8 laps, around laps 168 to 175. Now, here's the big question mark. Remember, Rusty only took on two tires on his last stop. Can they afford to go two rights only and leave those left side tires on for the final 96 laps? I don't think so. But Ricky Rudd made a four-tire change. I expect them to come in and maybe only change two rights and try to get off pit road in less than 10. Second.
Well, that's right, because they probably do not have to put a full tank of gasoline in the car. Probably maybe one can will get you into the end. If they had to put two cans of fuel in, they might as well change four tires, because they can do that just about as quickly as they can put the gasoline in the car. But one can, then they do have some real decisions to make, two or four.
They have not had to make green flag pit stops yet today. There's been enough cautions that they could come in and make them under caution. Here comes Ward Burton. He's making his pit stop a little bit early. Bill Weber.
And Ward's car just pushing very, very badly. So he's going to pit now. This should be four tires and fuel with an air pressure adjustment. to try and make the car better. Rusty York Wallace begins his trek down pit road. Some of these guys who took four tires on the last stop are going to be able to get by with two on this stop, and that could be the difference in the race. Left side tires going on for Ward. Plenty of fuel should be in there by now. Waiting on the lugs. He's away. We'll see what happens. Here's Jerry.
It will be four tires for Rusty Wells in the final scheduled pit stop. Earl Barbin slings the jacker on the left side. Left front coming off. Billy Wilburn, Robbie Fuller, the right rear coming off. Left rear. Good pit stop for Rusty. He's out of the way with a four-tire stop.
16.1 seconds, the final stop for Rusty Wallace coming on lap number 170.
Now that's going to put a lot of pressure on the rest of these teams to get in and get some fresh tires, because right now those stopwatches. Here we see 10 car coming in. John Kernan.
Four tires, guys.
James Hicks has told his crew four tires. We're going to take four tires, but who knows? He may change his mind in the middle of this pit stop. Johnny slides to a stop. They'll go to work on the right side. Only air pressure adjustment for the car, which is in pretty good shape. Now they do decide to go ahead and change all four tires. Left side going on. The gasoline second can going in. That's not a problem. And now the bug just a little bit low on the left front, but a pretty good. And Jeremy Mayfield is in right in front of the pit. Jeremy took on four tires as well. Did not see any adjustments. He is away.
Mike Skinner, Mark Martin is leaving the pit area in the Bible car.
He came down pit road side by side, Mark Martin, Jeremy Mayfield, and to go out, looks like Jeremy's going to beat Mark out. And all these cars are going to lap down as they make their pit stops. Of course, the leaders have yet to stop as Sterling Marlin comes in for his, what should be his last service, slides the wheels in there, they go to work on it.
Four-tire stop also for Sterling Marlin. And Bobby Labonte, second place, comes down. 55 miles an hour is the speed limit as he's headed toward Bill Weber.
And they've had some outstanding pit stops today. Jimmy Makar talking to his driver as they come down pit road. Bobby Labonte on his last pit stop took four. I expect them here to take two right-side tires, a half pound in the right front, right rear. They take the tear away off the windshield. Earnhardt getting right side tires. Labonte's already away. Left side's going on the three car, and now he continues the long trip down pit road at 55 miles per hour.
And we see Dale Jarrett also entering pit road. Robbie Gordon moves away from his pit box as Jarrett comes toward his.
All right, right sides, four tires. We saw Bobby Labonte, four tire change. He probably had a 3 or 4 second faster pit stop than Rusty Wallace, Bill.
Todd Parrott coaches Dale Jarrett into the stall, so get it close to the wall, stop it on the marks. Right side tires, they come around to the left side, he's got the fuel. A quick stop for the 88, 7.7 seconds. He moves away, the 75 comes in, we go to Jerry.
And Michael McSwain said, Ricky, you make the call. Two tires or four? Rudd said two, only two. Remember, Rusty Wallace pitted in a little over 16 seconds. They want to get Rudd out in 10 or less. Here he comes. We'll stop. We start the clock. Right side tires only. They peel the windshield off. Right front is on. Right rear is on. Norman Kosamitsu has one can of fuel in. 8.6, they get under 10 seconds, and that could possibly give them a shot at winning it here at Michigan.
Bobby Hamilton coming down pit road to Kodak Film Chevrolet. Steve Park sitting on pit road. Some indication he has lost his son in the Chevrolet.
The 99 car of Jeff Burton now rolls onto pit road. He led a lap before coming in. Matt Kenseth also on pit road. Begin work on the 17. We'll get down to Jerry for a call on the 99 stop.
X-side crew, right side only. They said push, push, push. Right side tires only for Jeff Burton. He's down and away. And Matt Kenseth also right side tires only for the Robbie Reiser DeWalt crew.
Wally Dahlenbach was in a while ago. He only took two tires. Here comes Kenny Wallace leaving the pits. Dale Earnhardt Jr. comes in. He checks the marks, and the crew goes to work on the Budweiser Chevy. And this will also be a two-tire stop, and he's out in 8 seconds.
Man, he did a hole shot, didn't he? He got out of there in a hurry.
Well, on the track, Ricky Rudd and Bobby Labonte have found each other.
It all shakes down. This ought to be the battle for the lead.
That's exactly right, Jimmy.
Yeah, the 16 car of Kevin LePage actually is leading right now, but he has yet to make his pit stop. And when he does, it will come down to a battle between Rudd and Labonte. There is Kevin LePage.
Rusty Wallace with his four tires is probably 3 or 4 seconds right now behind the 28 and the 18 as we see Kevin LePage come off the racetrack to make his last pit stop.
And with that, Rudd has the lead with Bobby Labonte right on his rear spoiler. Rusty Wallace now is 2.6 seconds behind. We'll see if he can close that gap. Dale Jarrett is fourth, and Jeff Burton is fifth. Seventh caution is out here at Michigan due to an accident involving Robbie Gordon. Dale Earnhardt Jr. also spun down into the grass here in front of the tri-oval. But this does raise considerable question as to what's going to happen regarding pit road and those who came in a few laps ago and took only two tires. Here's a replay of Gordon into the wall, and he hit it hard.
Comes off the corner, the car gets sideways, but he turns it back and corrects the car, and it comes back across and goes straight up into the wall as the right window blows out.
And right behind him, Dale Earnhardt Jr. also spun. There's Jr. down in the grass.
Check this out from Dale Earnhardt Jr.'s onboard camera. There he sees him spinning. And he just simply got down in the grass trying to avoid, and there's not a lot of traction down there.
Couldn't see.
Well, Dale, the lead cars were coming right up on this, Bob.
Yep. And he'd drive through the cloud of smoke and just hope that nobody's there. Down to John Kernan as some make pit stops.
Updating on Robbie Gordon, who just spun out coming out of turn number 4. He radioed his crew and said, I went to lift off the throttle, and the throttle was stuck down to the floor, so he spun it out. That was the problem. I know they had a problem a little bit earlier where they talked about giving him some two-sided tape to put on his shoe, on the sole of his shoe, during a caution so that he could would help him lift the throttle up. But that was the problem for Robbie Gordon and why he spun out in turn 4.
Well, those running up front did not make a pit stop here, despite the fact that they only made two. Some, however, did.
And Rusty Wallace now with his four tires is right behind the second place car of Bobby Labonte.
Yep, that 2.6 second advantage that Ricky Rudd had on Rusty before the caution now has gone. And that's the way the top 15 are running at the end of 179 laps. 26 cars on the lead lap. And the remainder of the field now.
See, Dale Earnhardt Jr., pole sitter, has lost a lap due to that spin.
Steve Park is having problems, and he is back behind the wall. Well, they're talking about changing the carburetor, I guess. He remains on the racetrack, but he is having problems. All right, under caution once again here at Michigan Speedway. We'll be back with a restart in a moment. For those of you tuning in for the X Games, stay with us because in 19 laps, the race will be over and we'll take you to San Francisco. These, ladies and gentlemen, are speed bikes. No engines or pedals, but plenty of velocity. So watch them race down Seal Rock Run coming up next on the X Games. Some pretty big crashes in those two.
Yeah, they do. That hurts just to see it.
You see, I've been talking about soft walls. That's exactly what I'm talking about.
Yep. Down to John Kirk.
And Robbie Gordon has climbed from his car. Robbie, a wild ride. I understand your throttle was sticking on you.
Yeah, we fought stuck throttle from about lap 20 on. Unfortunately, we're just trying to ride along and get somewhere in the top 25 as a result. Just moved into the top 20, so we're pretty happy about that. And, you know, it's just it's unfortunate. We knew we didn't have a car all weekend that was very good. We were just going to try to get through Michigan and get on to the next race.
Now, you've done some picking and choosing of races now to advance your team. How are you pleased with the results so far?
I was pleased with last weekend. I can't say I was pleased this weekend. Anytime you have to take provisional means you have to go back and do more homework.
All right, that's Robbie Gordon out of it for now, but fortunately he is okay.
And another driver having problems, continuing to have problems, is Steve Park, as they will raise the hood on the Pennzoil Chevy once again.
Steve Mealy is exhausted after trying to push the car to get it started. He's just kind of walking back to see what's going on. Now they'll have to work on the air cleaner and the carburetor. Once again, caution car off the speedway. 18 laps to go when they take the green flag. Who's it going to be?
Gets him a little bit of a jump. Have some lap cars this time. This is the first time since way back in the race when only Ricky Craven was on the lap car.
Rusty Wallace on the very bottom of the racetrack, and he tries to get a run on Bobby Labonte for second spot.
Labonte looks inside, back and forth, back and forth.
He's trying to scare Rusty Wallace there. It probably worked.
Well, Rusty's coming down on the inside, making him run.
And don't count Jared out of this thing. He's the fourth.
Well, they made some huge pits, some huge changes on that 88 car during a pit stop, and it looks like it's worked well. Here goes Rusty Wallace for the lead off two.
Well, I think those four tires that he's changed have worked to his advantage.
Down the backstretch, Wallace is side by side with Rudd, and Wallace takes the lead on lap 184.
And here comes Dale Jarrett down to the very bottom of the racetrack, trying to take over third from Bobby Labonte.
These three teammates pulled down the flag and helped him a little bit there as they were about to get together.
Meanwhile, Jeff Burton and Matt Kendrick back in fifth and sixth.
Jarrett still trying to get that third spot from Labonte. First and second in the points. They're battling for third position here in the late stages of this race.
And you wonder why that Ricky Rudd and Bobby Labonte, Dale Jarrett, did not choose to make a pit stop and change those left sides that they needed. They were going to give up so much track position, they just could not afford to do it.
Again, a reminder that as soon as we're finished with our race here in Michigan, we'll switch out to San Francisco and bring you the X Games.
His way forward. He's moved into the, well, let's see, is it fifth or sixth?
Trying to take over fifth there right now from Jeff Burton. Gets a run, moves down on the inside. See if Burton can come back on the outside. Matt King is still hanging in there tight.
We haven't seen Earnhardt run down there in a long time.
No, not 3 years ago, when we saw Earnhardt down there.
Benson and Kenseth are wheel to wheel as Jimmy Spencer looks on. Seventh, eighth, and ninth. Bobby Hamilton is in the top 10.
Well, great run for Spencer. He could stay there after starting, taking the divisional, starting back in about 39th spot.
And boy, Rusty has just checked out after he passed Bobby Labonte and Ricky Rudd. See how far back those cars are? You look out his rear view mirror, out his back window.
Well, it was 1.04 seconds last time around. We'll see if he increased that on this lap. And it's 1.38.
Well, what we've been seeing all race long is Rusty Wallace, when he changes four tires, just like all the other cars, he is really good for 15 or 20 laps. And then the difference in speed starts to lessen, and then those other cars start getting closer to him. But with just 13 laps to go, I'm not sure that these guys have enough time to catch Rusty.
I don't think so either. I think he's got him where he wants him.
Always like to mention milestones, and we haven't seen Michael Waltrip much today. He's running back in 23rd position, but we do want to mention that this is his 450th NASCAR Winston Cup start here this afternoon.
On board with Dale Jarrett as he goes down around the bottom of the racetrack where he's been since they took the rubbers out of the rear springs, and we see Earnhardt going by the 10 car and moving into the fifth position. Oh, we see a smoker, and it looks like the car has gotten in the wall.
Robert Presley. Will it bring out a caution?
Not yet.
Not yet. Presley has the car under control. And that's a tough break for Robert, who was in the top 10 and had just dropped out of it. And the interval is now up to 1.7 seconds. Rusty's last lap, 180.909. Rudd ran a 180.288. The X Games, second day of the X Games from San Francisco, coming up in just a moment, when we have completed a little more than 9 laps from right now.
I said that Presley might have hit the wall off turn 2, or he did hit the wall. I don't think that's the case, because I looked at the right side as he turned the car into the garage area, and I didn't see any contact with the wall, so it was something else that caused the smoke.
These three cars battling for the second position using different lines. Richard Rudd hangs on to second.
Rusty Wallace has won Winston Cup competition here at Michigan 4 times, 88, 89, 94, 96. He won in an ASA race here in 93, and he won an IROC race here in 91.
Good racetrack for him.
Yes, it has. Kenseth, Jeff Burton, and Jimmy Spencer are fighting it out. And you're right, BP. Jimmy has done a fine job today.
As they try to get by the 26, the 99 car, can't do it. Meanwhile, Bobby Hamilton running in 10th spot right now. That would be almost a mini victory to get a top 10, the struggle they've had this year in that Kodak Film Chevrolet.
Jeff Burton's car seems to have gone away. We heard earlier that the car belonged to Randy Tider at the get. So he's not doing as well as he would like to.
Matt Kenseth has been the highest finishing rookie in 13 of 21 races this year. And it looks like he may end up there again in this race. Dale Earnhardt Jr. is back in 27th spot. And Kenseth is in 7th. Came into this race leading the Revestas Rookie of the Year point standings by 23 over Little Lee.
Here comes Spencer. Oh, slide left. And he's trying to go by Kenseth as well.
Yeah. But they have that momentum from that high groove, and they pull him back around him again. Maybe he'll try it again the next turn. See if he comes into the picture. There he is. Gordon just pulled his car behind the wall. He made as many laps as he could. He couldn't pass anybody else, so he just pulled it out. And, of course, the 77 of Robert Presley is out now.
So Jeff will finish in the 36th position after that incident early on with Tony Stewart. No, it wasn't a situation where they intentionally wrecked each other. Tony lost control at the bottom of the racetrack, admitted that he lost it on his own, and the car slid right up in front of Jeff. Now Spencer is still working on Kenseth.
But meanwhile,
wow.
Oh, close.
Got closer.
Really close.
And Burton said, boys, please be careful.
I'm right behind you.
And Bobby Hamilton comes up. Spencer's not to give up. He's back on the bottom again. Look at Hamilton right in the middle of the racetrack. And here comes Mark Martin back in the fight.
Mark right now 11th.
Best race race on the racetrack. They are going at it.
Interval between first and second is 2.6 seconds. Rusty has indeed checked out.
Let's mark turn left. Get on the inside of Hamilton. Slide up in front of Burton. No, there's not room. Is there between the two? Yes. And Burton knew he was going to do that. That's why he just turned left.
And passed him right back.
Now he slides in that hole. Now Spencer goes back to the bottom of the racetrack.
Well, I did it one time. I'll do it again. Now watch him slide up there in front of him.
Look at Mark Martin.
Not this time.
Mark Martin on the very bottom of the racetrack. Yep, Spencer slid in that hole again. Here comes Ward Burton up on the outside of Mark Martin. Now Jeremy Mayfield drives to the inside. Look, you lose momentum coming off these corners and you're just, man, these other cars that have that momentum fly by you. Spencer once again trying and he might make it this time.
We only have just about three more laps to go.
Jimmy Spencer moves up to seventh. Tenth of eight. Burton 9th and Ward Burton now has moved up into 10th position.
Another car that's on the move is Johnny Benson. He's in 5th place. We saw him pass Mark Martin for 5th place. And now he has run down Dale Jarrett, who is running in 4th place. Only has a couple of more laps to make a pass, but he's been catching him at a pretty good clip.
They continue to fight it out. Tonight, we'll have for you an interview with the winner of our race here at Michigan, and we are going to have to switch immediately to San Francisco to catch up to date on what's happening at the X Games, day number two. And the white flag is out for Rusty Wallace. One more lap to go. We watch his battle back here for 9th, 10th, 11th on back. Rusty with almost a 3-second advantage as we continue to focus in on this battle. It's the best on the racetrack. There's no competition also between the 28 of Ricky Rudd and the 18 of Bobby Labonte. They're running second and third.
Martin had some damage to his left rear. That's certainly hurting his efforts as Rusty Wallace comes down to the checkered flag. It's Rusty Wallace with a victory.
As they cross the line, you see where they're going to finish. Benson in fifth. Here they come down to the line in this battle.
Ward might have got that position there.
Got it from Jeff. Martin finishes in 11th position. Hamilton with a 14th place finish. Terry Labonte in his return winds up in the 20th spot. Well, it's Rusty Wallace's 52nd career victory. And his fifth at Michigan and his second win in the Pepsi 400. He won also in 89. Again, the winner interview on RPM tonight. The X Games are coming up from San Francisco. Rusty Wallace wins the Pepsi 400. Now, let's go to the X Games in San Francisco.